Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business is consideration of the Legislative Consent Memorandum for the Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill, and I refer members to Papers 1 and 2. And I welcome Mary Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and our Scottish Government officials who are, they're not with us virtually, but they're certainly remote in terms of being at the back of the committee room. But welcome Andrew Vose, Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare, and Keith White, Solicitor. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I'm delighted to be before you today to discuss the Legislative Consent Memorandum to give effect in Scotland to the clauses of the Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill. Now, the bill will make provision about the welfare of certain kept animals that are imported or exported from Great Britain. The Scottish Government proposes legislative consent for the clauses related to prohibiting the export of animals for slaughter and fattening, animal welfare and retained direct EU legislation, the importation of dogs, cats, and ferrets, and to make amendments to the licensing of zoos in Great Britain. The provisions of the bill not extending to Scotland relate to the keeping, selling and breeding of primates and the offence of livestock worrying. The Scottish Government has the devolved power to legislate for the welfare of primates by secondary legislation. Also, the Scottish Parliament, through its support of the Dogs Protection of Livestock Amendment Scotland Act 2021, which came into force on the 5th of November, has already legislated to improve the protection of livestock from incidents of worrying. The Scottish Government recently committed to work with the other administrations to seek to end the unnecessary long-distance transport of animals for fattening or slaughter outside of the UK, and the bill provides an opportunity to have consistent control over such exports and to assist enforcement agencies to ensure that such unnecessary movements no longer take place. The Kept Animals Bill also makes provision for prohibiting or regulating the movement of animals into Scotland for the purpose of protecting animal welfare or animal health. Committee members will be all too aware that the importation of animals, and puppies in particular, involves widespread suffering and illegality. Puppies are frequently imported with fraudulent paperwork, underage and unvaccinated, before being transported and sold to unsuspecting buyers in GB by dealers illegally posing as home breeders. So reducing the number of pet animals that can be imported by individuals, along with restrictions on the import of young animals or in late pregnancy, will significantly help to address these issues. These measures have been called for by many of the main animal welfare organisations, and the Scottish Government supports their introduction. There are also concerns about the growing number of dogs imported with cropped ears and other unnecessary and cruel mutilations that are not legal within the UK, and the bill seeks to address this. The licensing of zoos has been applied consistently across Great Britain for many years, more recently under the provisions of the Zoo Licensing Act 1981. This consistent approach has worked well to protect animals kept in zoos, and I would like to see that approach continued. The proposed amendments to the 1981 Act seek to introduce more meaningful conservation, education and research activities for all licensed zoos through improved standards for modern zoo practice that have been developed by the Zoo's Expert Committee. And this will greatly improve the knowledge base around many animals and contribute to their future care. The Scottish Government fully recognises, however, that for the measures in this bill to be successful, it must be introduced consistently across Great Britain. This is to avoid unscrupulous importers and exporters seeking to change their point of entry or exit in an attempt to exploit any inconsistencies between administrations, which they no doubt would seek to do considering the high value of puppies and certain breeds of dogs. Consistent legislative measures across GB will also greatly assist when it comes to the interpretation and enforcement of new controls. A coordinated GB-wide approach to tackling the issues covered by the Kept Animals Bill is widely supported and welcomed by many key stakeholders. And I'm strongly of the view that allowing the UK Parliament to legislate for all GB administrations in these areas is the most timely, efficient and effective way to achieve these important changes.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now move on to questions. First, I would like to ask whether you have any intentions to make suggestions on how the bill might be strengthened. We've received a briefing paper from the Dogs Trust that suggests that 97% of owners have three or less dogs, whilst the legislation suggests that five dogs should be allowed to be imported under the pet owner scheme. Do you think that's appropriate, and have you any intention to try and strengthen that to ensure that we don't see the continuation of the puppy trafficking that we see through the likes of Cairn Ryan?
Well, I do think that the measures that are being proposed through the bill will have a significant impact as they stand. As I said, it will mean that the maximum number of animals that can be imported will be five, and that's per vehicle, so that's already a significant change. But again, we're in constant discussion with the animal welfare organisations, and I'm actually due to be meeting with the Dogs Trust this morning, where I'll no doubt be having that conversation with them. So I think it's important that we have that discussion with them and then discuss that with other administrations as to whether further amendment would be needed, but more than happy to obviously have that discussion and to consider that fully.
Okay, thank you. Could I move to Mercedes Villalba, please?
I had a question about the current provisions seem to have exceptions for tail docking of working dogs and declawing of cats. So does the Scottish Government, are you satisfied with the provision as it is? Do you feel that it goes far enough in light of those exceptions?
In relation to, well, it gives us the power to introduce regulations that will also help to prevent imports of dogs that have these mutilations that are actually illegal in the UK, right across the UK at the moment. And the work has been done on this through the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission as well. So again, I think that when these regulations are introduced, as well as some of the other measures that I've talked about there in terms of the minimum age that animals can be imported, some of these measures were recently consulted on and were currently analysing and looking at the results of the consultation into that, which closed in October. But I think once we introduce these further regulations, again, I do think that will have a significant impact and stop, hopefully, the importation of dogs where we see these mutilations.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Ask about zoo licensing.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In England, the UK government will deliver on a ban of keeping of primates as pets. So this will ensure that primates are kept up to zoo level standards, and also will phase out the ownership of primates. I was wondering if the Scottish government will be following suit.
Yes, in relation to this, this is something that we can already do in Scotland through secondary legislation. And of course, it's an area that is being that we continue to look at and consider. And again, the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission has been doing work on this in relation to the keeping of exotic pets. So we already have the power to look at and control that. I don't think it's not as straightforward in the legislation that's in at the moment, and that it would be a complete ban on the keeping of primates. And I think what they're looking to introduce through the legislation are powers that already exist here in Scotland for us to give effect to that. But I'll see if officials have any further information they want to add to that.
Yes, as the Cabinet Secretary says, we do have the power to introduce licensing regulations in Scotland, as we have recently done for licensing of animal rescue centres and cat, dog and rabbit breeding. And potentially we could introduce licensing for exotic pet keeping or primates. So that is something that's currently being considered by the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission. There's a working group specifically looking at exotic pet keeping. So we will be able to consider their recommendations in future and legislate if we think that's appropriate.
Can I just clarify why it is not able to be delivered as a commitment within this, the Animals Welfare Cat Bill?
Like I say, because we don't need the powers through the bill in order to give effect to that in Scotland. So it's not the fact that we're not going to do it, but we have the powers to enable us to do it. And as Andrew was just saying there, the SOC are already looking at this. So I think it makes sense for us to look at the work that they'll be producing and doing on this work before we take that forward.
Okay.
And Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. It's more of a point rather than a question. You're talking about the number of dogs that are being restricted to be brought over. I would just urge that when you are having conversations with Dog Trust this afternoon, that you're cognizant of the fact that people who have dogs as working companions will quite often have at least five dogs, so a shepherd, a keeper, guys like that will quite often, you get a lot of travel between Ireland and Scotland of shepherds coming over to work, and it's just to make sure that there's a provision in there for them to be able to do that. And in terms of the tail docking, I think it's absolutely essential that working dogs that are going to ground or undercover have got a shorter tail for their own welfare, because you'll have seen the evidence in the past of dogs that are working with big waggy tails going through undergrowth and coming out being shredded. So it's just something that you may be aware of, but I just wanted to point it out.
Thank you. I mean, I suppose in response to that, I mean, we're not looking to stop legitimate movements of animals, but I think the fact is that we do have a significant problem when it comes to the illegal trade of particularly puppies coming into the country. So I think it's important that we get the balance of these measures right. But like I say, that's where we're in constant discussion with various animal welfare organisations, as well as the British Veterinary Association, and as well as the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, to look at these proposals. And that's where I think what is proposed will really significantly impact the illegal trade, which is really what we want to clamp down on.
Thank you. Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
In relation to the ban on live animal exports for slaughter, I'd like to ask whether the Scottish Government is considering further regulations on animal transport and whether this will be progressed at a Scottish or UK level.
Well, that's what this bill gives effect to, and it gives us the power to make further regulations in relation to whether we wanted to make changes to animal transport legislation. But again, given the nature of movements of livestock in particular throughout GB, I think it makes sense for us to discuss that with other administrations if we are to make changes. We did consult on this earlier in the year and recently published the response to that consultation. But of course, if we're making any changes to animal transport, we will consult on any proposals that come forward as well, because obviously we also want to make sure that we don't disadvantage those that live in our remote and our island communities when it comes to animal movements. Thank you.
We've already corresponded with you on the topic of border controls. So can I ask, with reference to this bill, what are the implications for border controls in relation to both domestic and animal movements and the prohibition of livestock exports, including enforcement requirements in relation to movement between the UK and Ireland and the EU exit context?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that there will always remain that concern that even if across a GB level we implement these restrictions on imports of dogs, cats and ferrets, and like I say, that hopefully that will significantly impact the illegal trade that currently takes place. I think we have to obviously be cognizant of what tends to be criminal enterprises and organisations that can be behind these movements anyway, and they'll obviously looking for any avenue to get access. So, of course, there will always be that threat that they could then export, or there could be movements into Northern Ireland from the EU that would then have access in through Scotland. So I think that's something that we will just have to pay close attention to. But like I say, hopefully with all the measures that are proposed in the bill, the powers that we're given and the regulations that will be coming in future will have a significant impact on that trade. But I think that element in particular is one that we'll have to keep a close watch on.
Okay, thank you. Just another one on zoos. There was some correspondence suggesting that the timescales for implementation of some of the new regulations, the conservation aspects were all very welcome, but have you any concerns that the timescales may put some of our zoos and conservation parks in Scotland at risk because of the short timescales potentially they'll have to implement any of the policies that come forward in the bill?
Well, I believe that the draft standards that are being proposed are due to go out to consultation shortly. I'm not personally aware of those concerns. They haven't been raised directly with me, but I don't know if Andrew has more information on that, or if those are concerns that have been raised with officials in that regard.
Yes, I think once the draft standards are available and are with the zoos for consultation, I think that will help greatly, because they will then have a better understanding of exactly what those draft standards are proposing, and they can consider how much work will be required to make any changes that are necessary to meet those standards.
Okay. And finally, looking at secondary legislation, can you tell us how the Scottish Government will engage with the Scottish Parliament and Scottish stakeholders when it comes to any secondary legislation made under the powers in this bill?
Mm-hmm. Well, in relation to part three of that, it requires that regulations are subject to the affirmative procedure. So whether if we're making those regulations in Scotland, then of course that would be scrutinised by the committee and there would be the opportunity for that. But of course, if we also give consent for, say, the Secretary of State to legislate on our behalf, then we would go through the usual processes for that as well. And again, it's subject to the affirmative procedure, so we'd fully intend to work with the committee and keep you informed and ensure that scrutiny is able to take place.
Thank you. And Jenny.
Thank you. Thanks. Kind of returning to the first question, I'm interested to know how you think the legislation will help when you have minibuses with more than one person in it, perhaps trying to bring in larger numbers of young pups or kittens. How you think this legislation will help?
I think it will help with that in a number of ways. So, first of all, like what you talked about there, that example of having that minibus full of animals, depending on the number of individuals that are there, that wouldn't be possible anymore. So it would be a maximum of 5 animals per vehicle, regardless of the number of individuals that are in there. So I think that it would have a significant impact in that regard. But I do think we'll also see those changes when the regulations are implemented. So I think one of the biggest changes and most positive will be in relation to the movement of, when we have the age limit, are we able to introduce that? So that could be, say, we could prevent the import of dogs that are under 6 months old. So we think that would significantly impact the trade, as well as the proposals that are subject to future regulations in relation to moving heavily pregnant dogs as well. So I think with all these measures combined, all of that will really hopefully put a stop to that trade. But like I say, there are certainly elements that we'll have to keep a close eye on.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Beatrice.
Yes, just following on from that question, I was just intrigued about the figure of 5 for animals travelling in a car, but if they come in any other way by air or by foot passenger, that's limited to 3. So I just wondered if I could get an understanding of the reasoning behind that figure.
I don't know if officials will have further information as to how we've arrived at these numbers.
Yeah, I think there obviously needs to be a balance between allowing reasonable movements of families and family groups who may have, you know, a few animals between them, and reducing the limit. Currently, the limit is 5 animals per person, and as we've heard, that could mean that in a minibus you could have 6 people bringing in 30 pups, so that will stop. That is the proposal at the moment. The 5 animals per vehicle, as we've said, the Dogs Trust have been lobbying to have that reduced, and that is a possibility. We'd obviously want to discuss that with the other GB administrations. But I think the number, the 5 animals per person, comes from current EU legislation. So there has to be a reasonable level set that allows reasonable movements and legitimate movements, but does have an impact on the sort of abuse of the pet travel scheme that is going on at the moment.
Thanks.
Okay, no further questions. Okay, thank you very much. Can I now ask the committee whether they're satisfied to delegate authority to me to sign off the committee's report to the Parliament on the LCM? Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now briefly suspend to allow a changeover in witnesses. Our next item of business is consideration of the Eggs Amendment Scotland Regulations 2021. These regulations are subject to the affirmative procedure and I refer members to Paper 3. I once again welcome Mary Goujon, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs in our island, and her government officials for this agenda item. We've got Judith Brown, Solicitor, Joe Kirk, Senior Poultry Officer, and Kevin Matheson, Livestock Policy Manager. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to crack on with her opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for having me to speak about the Eggs Amendment Scotland Regulations 2021. Now, this draft instrument amends retained regulation EC number 589/2008 on the marketing standards for eggs with regards to checks done on imported Class A eggs. At the moment, checks for Class A egg marketing standards take place at the point of destination, such as egg packing centres and wholesale premises. However, for eggs imported from third countries, the retained EU regulation requires that these checks are carried out at the time of customs clearance. Now, given that the UK has left the EU, this means a greater number of checks would need to be made at the border. This amendment, therefore, enables marketing standards checks to continue to be undertaken on imported Class A eggs at the point of destination rather than at customs. The checks are and will continue to be undertaken by suitably qualified egg marketing inspectors prior to release for retail sale or for mass catering. This amendment also enables checks on imported Class A eggs to take place where existing resources are already established and where there is already expertise, and thus we believe this approach to be more efficient and more practical. In reality, there are currently no imports of eggs direct into Scotland from the EU or elsewhere, other than infrequent and small quantities from the Republic of Ireland, although some eggs do arrive into Scotland from the EU via English ports. For that reason, the UK and Welsh governments are also taking forward corresponding amendments for their jurisdictions. So I hope that these remarks are helpful in setting out the rationale for the draft instrument, and I'm of course happy to take any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll kick off with a question. Given it's now quite some time since we left the EU, why is it only now that this legislation is coming forward?
Of course, there has been an awful lot of work that's had to be undertaken very quickly and at pace since we've left the EU. And like I say, this SSI really effectively brings... puts into legislation what has been happening in practice in relation to the checks at points of destination. So that's why it's coming forward at this time.
Okay. And on that, are we likely to see other SSIs on other products to allow inspections at place of destination rather than potentially at border crossings? Are we likely to see more instruments such as this?
It's not possible for me to give you a definitive answer today in relation to that, but I'd be happy to come back to you with further information.
Okay. Rachel.
The policy note states that Class A eggs are rarely imported, as you said, Cabinet Secretary. Do we know how many eggs are imported?
Well, like I say, at the moment, it is just very infrequent movements that we have and very small quantities that currently come directly into Scotland from the Republic of Ireland. I don't know if officials have the information as to exactly what those numbers look like.
No, it's just as Cabinet Secretary was saying, very small amounts coming from the Republic of Ireland into Scotland at the moment. This whole amendment is about future-proofing in case we ever get an influx, you know, of imports in the future. That's the whole point.
So if we don't, if we have a de minimis number of Class A eggs coming in, at what stage is this monitored all along? I mean, are there veterinary inspectors there or other inspectors to ensure that we don't have fraud and keeping those measures in place?
Well, we do have highly trained inspectors that currently undertake this work, and I think that that's also the point of this of this SSI as well, because what it means is that we can really focus the resource that we have in and it actually means that more inspections will be able to take place rather than if they were to determine that they were to take place at a customs checkpoint. That would actually split the resources that we have and take our inspectors away from the work that they're currently doing and the checks that they already undertake. So it allows us to better utilise the resource that we have at the moment. And I would say in relation to the checks too, I mean, this SSI doesn't change any of the checks that actually take place. All it does is change where they take place.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah, very quick one. I'm assuming that this is eggs still in the shell, not liquid or powdered eggs.
Yes.
Thank you. Can I ask, what consultation did you have with egg packaging and wholesale organisations to look at the pros and cons of this instrument? And were there any cons, if you like? Was there any adverse impact of the wholesalers and whatever carrying out the inspections rather than at a border post?
Yes, there was a consultation that was done on a GB basis, and from what I understand from that, NFUS were the only Scottish stakeholders to take part in that consultation, and their comments on the proposals were that it made sense. However, I think that there had been other opinions within that consultation as well, I believe from the Egg Council, and DEFRA had held a round table with them, but I'll pass over to officials who can give more information as to their comments on the proposals.
Okay, so a roundtable was held to, you know, speak through any issues there were. We made the point, Scottish Government Poultry Inspector made the point that we were far more likely to uphold inspection, the marketing standards if we could do it at packing centres and wholesale premises, because that's where our resources are, that's where we're set up to do it. As the Cabinet Secretary was saying, if we were to take away from routine inspections and put staff at these posts, this would result in, you know, a watered-down version of checks elsewhere. So there was no dissent, I think that's fair to say, there was no dissent following the round table.
Jim Fairley.
One very brief one, it's probably to yourself, Kevin. What would the potential threats be if we were importing eggs from another country to our industry?
I think there's a competition. I think domestic, maybe Joe's got a better idea here, but I think domestic eggs and one of the things that came up in the consultation was as long as we have the same checks applied to import as we do in domestic, we'll be happy. So, you know, again, we went back to the point that the best way we can guarantee that is to do it at the points of destination.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions? If not, we'll move on to formal consideration of the motion, which is agenda item 3. I would invite Ms Goujon to move the motion for S6M 01816.
Formally moved.
Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. If the committee is content to recommend approval of this, is the committee content to recommend approval of this instrument? Thank you. Finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on our deliberations on this affirmative instrument? Thank you. Excellent. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our officials for attending today. We will now suspend till agenda item 4. Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. Our main item of business this morning is the first in a series of evidence sessions looking at the climate and nature emergencies. And today we'll be focusing on the science behind the climate and nature emergencies, particularly as they relate to the rural economy. I welcome to the meeting our first panel, who will be discussing the marine environment. So welcome to Professor Bill Austin, who's the Chair of Scotland's Blue Carbon Forum, Sir Ian Boyd, a Marine Mammal Specialist from the University of St Andrews, Susan Davis, Head of the Scottish Seabird Centre, Professor Paul Fernandez, Chair of Fisheries Science from Aberdeen University, and Dr Tara Marshall, Senior Lecturer in Fisheries Science and University of Aberdeen. So we'll now kick off with some questions, and I'd like to start. So we see many reports from the likes of IPCC on global findings, but can I ask how applicable are those findings on biodiversity loss and climate change in the in Scotland's marine environment, and whether the levels of pressures differ in Scotland from the rest of the world, and what how the impacts are likely to be different. And if I kick off with Professor Austin, please.
Good morning. Thank you for the question. My point would be, in answering this question, that this is a global challenge, and that Scotland, as with many other countries, faces these same challenges. The biodiversity loss in our seas is growing, and I think one of the things that we need to be aware of is that nature and climate need to be thought of in the same round. So my point would be, and probably come back to this, that we have a wonderful natural capital in our seas in Scotland, and opportunities, I think, for nature-based solutions. Thank you.
Thank you. And Sir Ian Boyd?
Well, I think I would definitely agree with Bill Austin. This is Scotland in a global context. I think Scotland needs to play its part. Scotland has particular assets, natural assets, and its marine system is a particular asset. It's very large relative to its land area, and it's very rich in certain ways, particularly in terms of its renewables, but also to some extent its biological richness as well. And, you know, if we're going to repair the global environment, then, you know, Scotland is not an insignificant part of that and needs to play its part. Just in terms of the sort of impacts of climate change and also the work of ITBES, the Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Function, I mean, Scotland is probably less affected than many other parts of the world. Most of the climate change impacts are really going to be felt in the global south and in the tropical regions of the world. But nevertheless, there will be impacts. We do have sea level rise. We have coastal communities that are vulnerable to sea level rise. As Bill Austin said, you know, we are seeing changes in biodiversity, some of which may not be related to things like climate change, but maybe natural, but actually quite a lot of them probably are. And distinguishing that signal of climate change from the noise of natural variation is always a very difficult thing to do. But nevertheless, we are becoming better and better at zeroing back to what signals are represented in biodiversity in particular from climate change. So, you know, Scotland is not immune from those impacts. And, you know, we do rely hugely on our marine area, particularly for food production. And that's not just direct, you know, capture fisheries, but it's also our aquaculture. Our aquaculture has an environmental footprint that extends well beyond Scotland. And, you know, for those things to thrive, Scotland has got to play its part. The other thing that we must be very careful of is that Scotland does not export its response to this to other parts of the world that are more vulnerable too. So all these things put together, you know, Scotland can't say that it's immune from this. It's probably going to be impacted slightly less, but it's got to play its part in a very, very substantial way to try and solve this problem at a global scale. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Susan Davis now, but just on the back of those comments, I'm quite surprised to hear that Scotland might not be affected just as much as some of the nations in the ecology in the global south. You know, obviously we hear about coral reefs and whatever, and our warmer seas being depleted, and these make news headlines, but. You know, here in Scotland, we're worried about our wild salmon populations. We hear about the reduction in the levels of food available to our puffins, our birds, with sand eels moving further north and so on. And we hear about our shoals of fish year on year moving further north into the colder waters. So, Susan, can I ask you, When we look at the impact in Scotland, so it could be the rise in a water temperature, global warming leading to the loss of oxygen, the increase in carbon dioxide. How does it affect us in Scotland? How do you see that affecting bird life, for example?
Yes, thank you. Absolutely, we do see a wide range of effects on the wildlife within Scotland. Half of Scottish species have decreased in abundance over the last 20 years, and the unsustainable fisheries is one contributing factor to that. And if we think about Scotland on the world stage, we obviously have internationally important populations of breeding seabirds. And globally, seabirds are considered to be the most vulnerable group of birds. And within the UK, 22 breeding species are now either on the red or the amber list of the Birds of Conservation Concern. We see that since 1986, that the breeding numbers have declined significantly by 56%. Making the connection through to climate change, many of those that are affected are the surface feeders, such as the black-legged kittiwake being one of the classic examples, but other species as well, such as the Atlantic puffin. And a new report by BTO has modelled through that perhaps within the next 30 years, 9 out of 10 puffins may have been lost in the UK. So there is undoubtedly, if you use seabirds as an example, a wide-ranging effect, and we have a responsibility to address that. It is, however, as Ian Boyd has said, it's not just about climate change. We also have fisheries issues, we have invasive species issues, marine pollution, marine litter, which are affecting those environments too.
Thank you. On the back of that, you know, I sometimes feel that a lot of the species loss that we see in Scotland is not right in front of our noses. So we don't notice that sand eel and feed stocks are moving further north, or the general public are not aware of the cod getting closer to the Arctic Circle and whatever. So just on that point, Professor Fernandes, can you give us an idea of what's happening to our fisheries? Obviously below the sea, and we can't see right in front of us what's happening. Could you give us an indication of how you feel climate change is affecting our fisheries in Scotland?
Well, there are two points to make on that. The first is it's a little complicated by the fact that fisheries management has changed a lot in the last 20 years. And I'll give you a good example. If you think about the North Sea, the west of Scotland, we have much lower quantities of cod, but we have huge quantities of hake that have appeared. And that's largely because management regimes changes.
Professor, can I stop you just a second? We're struggling to hear you. Could you possibly move closer to the microphone?
Sorry, can you hear me now? Is that better?
If you could just bear with us a second, we're going to try and improve the sound quality.
Is that better?
Not yet.
We're fine in the test.
Let me just bear with us.
Okay.
Okay, welcome back. Hopefully, we our IT glitches are over. And Professor Fernandez, can I go back to you again about climate change and the impact on fishing stocks in Scotland? Thank you.
Yeah, I was just making the point that climate change is undoubtedly having an effect on our stocks. As you mentioned, we're seeing species move either further north or into deeper waters. But it's hard to tease that apart from another big change that has happened that people are less aware of, and that is the fisheries management changes over the last 20 years, which means that we're taking less out of the sea than we used to. And in the 90s, we were taking around 60% of our adult populations in fishing. Now we're down to 20 to 30%. That's a huge reduction in exploitation, and that has had a positive effect on most of our fish stocks. And so if you look at the sort of top 10 species of interest to Scotland, mackerel, prawns, haddock, cod, anglerfish, herring and hake, with the exception of cod, all of those stocks are doing rather well. They have reasonably high biomasses and they're being sustainably fished. And the interesting one there in respect to climate change is cod, because that is probably suffering from the effects of the movements north. There's very little cod in the southern North Sea. There's much more in the northern North Sea. But there is more hake now in the northern North Sea than there ever was. And hake is a competitor for cod in many respects. And so whilst there is very little amounts of cod in both the west of Scotland and the North Sea, there are huge amounts of hake, and hake are similar things to eat. But we just don't have the quota, and this will come back later perhaps to how we manage our fisheries going forward, because these changes will have to be reflected in how we manage our fisheries, both from a sustainability point of view, but also from an allocation point of view.
Thank you. Dr. Tara Marshall, would you like to make any further comment?
No, I would agree with Paul's assessment, is that the fishing mortality has declined dramatically. So that's very important to keep in mind. But climate change is impacting the basic biology of fish. We know that fish are what is called cold-blooded. That means their metabolism scales with temperature. So it's going to impact how quickly their little internal combustion engine runs. That will impact their growth rates, how quickly they grow large. That impacts their reproductive rates, when they spawn in the seasonal cycle, and the overall fecundity of an individual fish, how quickly they mature. So all of those impacts on the basic biology of the fish will impact the yields. There will be some winners, there will be some losers. To come back to your biodiversity point, what we're seeing is incursions of warm water species in UK waters, and that's actually increasing the richness of the fish community.
That's fascinating. I'm about to move on because at the risk of hogging this whole session, you talk about the changes in growth and whatever. Dr. Marshall, do warmer waters increase growth rates, or because they're cold water metabolizing fish, if you like, the cod, does it slow it down? Does it have the adverse effect of what we would normally think, that warm water increases growth? So it's actually the exact opposite.
Yes, you are thinking like a biologist, so my congratulations to you. They do grow. Their engines run faster at higher temperatures. What that causes is them to grow very quickly as juveniles. So they'll grow fast as when they're young. They'll reach sexual maturation, and the growth rates will slow to virtually nothing. So in fact, they don't grow as large as adults as they used to. And we're seeing that very much in the haddock fishery right at the moment. There's real problems in Scotland. They're not landing large haddock. Those are more in the Norwegian waters that they no longer have access to, or have less access to. So these growth impacts, in essence, reduce yields, because smaller fish means that it means you have to catch more, numerically more, to make up a ton.
I learnt something as a graduate, a science graduate of Aberdeen University many years ago, so thank you. I'm now going to move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much. I don't know if this is a question for Professor Austin, possibly others have an interest in it too, but the issue of rising sea levels obviously presents an existential threat to some parts of the world. I found myself speaking to a politician from Tuvalu a few days ago who made that very point. But it obviously has some impact, as was mentioned earlier on the Scottish coastline as well. I represent the Western Isles, so I have a particular interest in that issue. But I wonder, could you say a bit more about what the trajectory is and what you would expect to see, for instance, on the west coast of Scotland over the next few decades ahead?
Yes, thank you. That's a great question. And I think the point about Tuvalu and some of the most vulnerable in the world, speaks to that same point that we discussed earlier. Yes, sea level will continue to rise, and this is one of the sobering facts that the IPCC have raised in their recent reporting just over a month or so ago now, this code red for humanity. And, one of the things we all have to, I think, grasp is that our greenhouse gas emissions collectively, globally, historically, are driving these changes, and that sea level rise in particular will continue. So this does, I think, mean that our coastal communities, our coastal habitats as well, are going to be vulnerable. And we're going to need to think about adaptation strategies. So we are, I think, increasingly thinking about natural systems as needing to respond, thinking about ways to realign our coastlines to create the natural adaptation they give us, the protection they give us, but also some of the ecological benefits they give us. This is far more challenging for us as communities. And I think, your constituency, Western Isles, is, I think, facing some of those challenges. We will, I think, need to spend more where it's appropriate on coastal defence. But in some other areas, I think marine planning needs to accept that we will need to realign our coastlines and probably work with our communities to support those changes ahead. So I think that's all I can really say there.
Yeah, on the back of that point, an example I've often quoted in my own constituency is where a school has had to move because of the very phenomenon you're talking about. So I wonder, can you say something about what you, or if any attempt has been made to try and quantify the kind of costs ahead in the coming decades just to try and cope with the problems that infrastructure will face in Scotland as a result of rising sea levels?
Yes, again, I think the economics of this, the economics of nature, the economics of our, if you like, our natural capital do need to change. So I think there are some challenges ahead for us. Infrastructure costs are very high in the face of sea level rise and may be unsustainable. So I think one of the things that we will need to do, and our Dynamic Coasts colleagues funded by the Scottish Government have been doing this. I've been doing some work with sports, with golf courses, so Montrose Golf Course in the northeast, eroding very significantly every winter. So, we need to look across the piece here, but I think the projections, we do have the science now to do this. There is uncertainty going forward, and that's because the concentration pathways of greenhouse gases that go into the atmosphere, that drive global warming, that then drive sea level rise, carry some uncertainties. But there's no reason for us not to be able to model the economic costs. I suspect that the insurance, or rather the reinsurance industry, is looking at this quite carefully. and that there is the expertise out there to do this. But as I say, I think this has to be central to our marine planning systems going forward.
COP has produced, I think and I hope, a much deeper and wider public interest and understanding of some of these very issues. But I was certainly shocked to look at some of the statistics that suggest that half a degree warming between, if you go from 1.5 to 2, that doubles some of the consequences that we're talking about, makes them dramatically twice as difficult. So I just wonder, can you give, or can others perhaps in the panel give some kind of illustration of the difference between 1.5 and 2, or the difference between these different scenarios that face us if we don't do something in the next 12 months between now and the next COP? Can you give some kind of illustration of what that means for the coastline in Scotland, the difference between those two scenarios?
Yes, I mean, very briefly, those scenarios would play out, as I've said, through these what are called representative concentration pathways. These are the model-based projections that drive our climate and then drive sea level rise. As I say, there are uncertainties, and so we need to accept that there are some uncertainties in those projections. But half a degree is going to translate here in Scotland, you know, to the order of tens of centimetres of potentially of sea level change by the end of the century. So these are, you know, long-term changes that, you know, we cannot avoid. And they are coming. The degree to which they come, I agree with you, depends on the international community. This is a global problem. Scotland can play its part. The net zero agenda, of course, is important there. And I think, you know, leveraging this message is really important, because, you know, this is where we will experience global warming through sea level rise, you know, in a very real way.
And, Professor Sir Ian Boyd, on those points, please, before I bring in Arianna Burgess for a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, Bill has, to some extent, answered the question in the way I would have done as well. I think we rely very much on the UK's climate projections that were updated in 2018 for information about sea level rise, and that suggests that, you know, the lower end is kind of up to half a metre by the end of the century, and at the upper end you're talking about a metre or more in terms of sea level rise. Now, to some extent that doesn't sound a huge amount, but when you add that on top of extreme weather events, you're starting to get extreme scenarios that do cause problems in coastal areas, and we're talking mainly about coastal communities here. One of the advantages of the UK CP18 scenarios and projections is that in future, planners and engineers should be able to build that into the design scenarios for infrastructure. If they're not, then they definitely should be, and I think it should be an absolute requirement of planning and infrastructure development that it is required. The problem, of course, is our legacy, in that we haven't always done this, and we've built on coastal areas which may well be vulnerable in the future. Actually, quantifying the cost of protecting those areas or moving people out of those areas is something that, as far as I know, has not been done yet. But as Bill says, the costs will be very, very substantial. And they will be they'll probably have more effect on the East Coast than the West Coast. That's just because sea level rise on the East is rather greater, and the probability of coastal flooding is rather greater on the East than the West Coast. And it's partly in the nature of the physical structure of the coastlines as well. But that's just to give you an impression of where the vulnerabilities lie and the kind of science that underpins the projections that we can make into the future. Thank you.
And we've got a brief supplementary from Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. Professor Ian Boyd, I'd like to just pick up on you're talking about the need to really look at changing infrastructure in our coastal communities. And I wondered if you'd had a chance to have a look at the National Planning Framework 4 yet, and maybe you haven't because it came out recently and it's quite a big tome. But do you think that it reflects that need for the radical change for our coastal communities? Do the policies and the spatial planning really give us the right steer to the radical level that we need to be doing things?
I'm sorry to say I haven't looked at it, so I really can't comment, and I should look at it, actually. It would be utterly amazing if it had not taken that into account. But as to its tone, I can't comment at this stage. My feeling is that the tone of any document like that would need to be expressing quite high levels of ambition.
I just open that question up to everybody else on the panel, just in case somebody has had a chance to have a quick look at it. Not yet. Okay. I hope it's going to be all on your list of your big reading list of things to read.
PF4 will be something that we come to in a committee sooner than we expected, and there'll be a bit of work to do there. Can I now move on to questions on blue carbon from Ceres Villalba?
Thank you. I think it makes sense to start with Professor Bill Austin. So my first question is, how important is carbon capture and storage in marine and coastal environments in terms of climate change? And what do you see as the main pressures on these blue carbon stores in Scotland?
Thank you. I think I would begin by recognising, as COP26, I think, has the growing significance of our oceans in our climate system. So I think many of us were very pleased to see the ocean climate nexus conversation growing at COP26. And as chair of the Scottish Blue Carbon Forum, I was very pleased to see blue carbon moving up at the agenda in terms of nature-based solutions that provide both climate mitigation and adaptation potential. So I think I'm going to say this is important. Nature-based solutions we know are probably extremely important in the overall goals of net zero. They probably offer us up to 30% of what we need to achieve in terms of the emissions reductions. And this creates, you know, really exciting opportunities to reimagine nature and to think about our wealth, as I said before, Scotland's wealth of natural capital. And as Sir Ian said, you know, our oceans are a very important part of that story. So blue carbon, I think, is important. The main pressures we face are, in fact, going back to the previous question in terms of our coastal wetlands, sea level rise. And historically, in parts of the UK, we've lost up to 80-85% of these wetlands. And area for area, they're the most effective habitats on our planet for sequestering and storing carbon. So they are extremely important. They give us a lot of benefit for relatively small areas. In the offshore, we're broadening our concepts of blue carbon. And I think one of the pressures we're realizing is of avoided emissions, if I can put it that way. The idea that our shelf sea sediments, for example, store vast quantities of carbon, and that pressures on the seabed are actually driving some losses, and those losses are potentially avoided emissions. The science there is quite challenging. it's quite early days, but we are doing well, I would say, in Scotland in developing our understanding of this science. You know, it's probably 1-3% at best of net zero for us in terms of blue carbon. But the sooner we start to protect and repair these systems, the sooner they build the sinks. And as we get closer to net zero, I think the other point I would make is that they become increasingly important. And the analogy I would give you that I think everybody would appreciate here in Scotland, and a point which Andrew Miller made for us recently, we had a conference on this theme during COP26, our chief scientific advisor, environment, spoke. The analogy is our peatlands. And, you know, the great success story of the peatlands, I think, has been to recognize the need for their restoration, both to avoid those emissions and to repair those, you know, globally important ecosystems. And I think we can do the same for marine. So I'm very optimistic, but we, you know, we have an opportunity and some challenges here. Thank you.
Ask Rachel for a supplementary, please.
It's to Professor Austin on that particular point. I just wondered if you believe that the Scottish Government should have its own strategy to restore and protect those blue carbon habitats you talked about. And again, a supplementary to what you said about measuring carbon, blue carbon, how do you actually do that? Because there are various groups out there that say that, you know, blue carbon doesn't actually go into the atmosphere. So can you tell the committee how that works?
Well, it depends how much time you have, but yes, I could try. First of all, in terms of Scottish Government strategy, I would like to commend government in terms of its support for this area, and I think that's very positive. We've just heard recently from UK government that they will follow suit now and establish a UK-wide partnership, but we've had this work in Scotland for a number of years. So I think we are leading here by example. In terms of, you know, the avoided emissions question, I think you're probably focused on our shelf seas and some of the claims for emissions from particularly bottom trawling. And globally, it's been claimed that trawling disturbance of our seabed is equivalent to the global emission from aviation. I think the evidence there is weak. And in fact, we're doing some work within the forum which suggests that that's not the case. But there are parts of our seabed which are more vulnerable to disturbance. We call these blue carbon hotspots. And I was very pleased to see that Scottish Government announced in August a new commitment to marine protection that would, for the first time, develop highly protected marine area networks that would look at blue carbon and its vulnerability. So I think, you know, the dialogue is changing. It's very exciting for us in a way that designation for marine protection could now move forward and encompass blue carbon thinking. And I think that's the right way forward. You know, it's putting climate and nature together and recognizing the services that nature provide through blue carbon. These are natural ecosystem functions. And blue carbon does offer us that. The science is much stronger, I think, for our coastal wetlands. We need to understand a little bit more about their emissions of greenhouse gases, but we have a very good understanding of the stocks, and we're certainly working with Bayes and colleagues in DEFRA at the moment to try and move this particular habitat, which falls under the IPCC guidelines, so it's in the framework, we could move this habitat into our national greenhouse gas inventory. And in the same way as we did with our peatlands, I think this will drive an important impetus for greater protection, greater restoration. And of course, opportunities for investment. We can tie these schemes to coastal flood protection and build in the blue carbon as something that investors are extremely interested in, so that this doesn't have to be entirely something that we expect government to pay for. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just before I bring Susan Davison, I've got a quick question. You mentioned bottom trawling and whatever, and it's one of these very emotive points, and you maybe regret mentioning it, but suggested that there was some evidence out there that the bottom trawling industry emitted as much carbon as aviation, but that was a weak argument. This is one of the issues where science is absolutely crucial in ensuring that we address the big ticket numbers rather than the ones that have an emotive response. So can you tell me, when it comes to blue carbon, there's the physical disturbances we've discussed, there's climate change, land use and land management changes. Just exactly how critical in that equation is physical disturbance compared to other climate change factors in terms of, for example, carbon dioxide in the ocean and its ability to sequestrate carbon dioxide, and whether we're at the tipping point for that changing. So just how important is a physical disturbance in the big picture?
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I don't regret mentioning bottom trawling. There is scientific literature arguing that this is an important impact on our shelf seas. I would recognise that we have a fishing industry and that we have a range of stakeholders, and that it's incumbent on us to have an evidence base, as you just pointed out, to make these sorts of decisions. As I said, I think some of that science has been questioned, and I would question it myself. And I think currently the science evidence base needs to be stronger in this area. But there is absolutely no doubt that, and Marine Scotland colleagues I'm sure would tell us this, that bottom trawling does damage benthic marine ecosystems, and that we need to be thinking far more carefully about this resource, this natural capital on our seabed, in terms of, the management of our fisheries, and just, realizing that this is a part of that story. It's not about, stopping the activity. It's perhaps about thinking how to more effectively manage the activity with the avoided emissions that I mentioned built into the prioritisation of perhaps these highly protected marine areas that government has committed to developing.
Thank you very much. I've got three people who would like to comment. So can I firstly go to Susan and then Paul and finally Ian on blue carbon, then we're going to move on to sustainable fisheries.
Thank you. I would just like to echo much of what Bill Austin has outlined there. I think in particular the illustration in relation to the carbon storage potential in our marine sediments and that in our peatland resource. So there's much more potential for carbon storage in our marine sediments. So it is important that we do protect those. I think as well, we have the marine protected area system. We have some knowledge about our blue stock and the distribution of that. But we need to ensure that in addition to that being built into the management measures for our marine protected areas, that it's also taken forward into marine spatial planning and into our regional plan system as well in the marine environment. So there is much to be done there. And whilst we have some of these protected areas and the commitment to strictly protect within 10% of the marine protected areas, that hasn't yet translated into actual reality in our seas. So it's important that we make progress in those areas.
Yeah, go ahead, Professor.
So I just wanted to come back on the point about trawling. it is a contentious issue, but on the issue in relation to how much carbon is emitted by that activity, you need to be clear. I think Bill alluded to this, that was based on one scientific article in one section of that scientific article, just one in 2021, and it made a lot of impact. But the science associated with that estimate is very contentious. It's based on a model of carbon deposition in the sediments that is contentious at the very least. There are estimates from the University of Strathclyde which are in complete contrast to that. For example, that paper says that there's lots of carbon in the southern North Sea, whereas measurements made by the University of Strathclyde suggest that actually most of it is in the northern North Sea in deeper sediments associated with mud. So all in all, there is a suggestion that that particular paper overestimated the amount of carbon being released by at least an order of magnitude. And I think it just needs to point out that the science associated with that particular activity is very much in its infancy and more needs to be done. But then in terms of the impact of trawling on biodiversity and our habitats, we also need to bear in mind that there has been a lot of marine protected areas, some of which have had management interventions to stop trawling in sensitive areas, for example, in our deep water coral to the west of Scotland in the Rockall area for 10, 15 years now. And what I think we need is to look at the marine protected areas that we do have now and introduce the appropriate legislation to prevent trawling where it affects those habitats, because there is still a large part of the North Sea in particular, which may not have the sensitive habitats that would suffer as a result of trawling.
Thank you. And Ian Boyd.
Thank you, convener. I agree with all that's been said so far, but I think that, however, I really emphasise the importance of blue carbon actually here, and I think that overall we underestimate the importance, at least at a Scottish level. Our sea area is about five times our land area, and our ability to fix carbon from the atmosphere is probably roughly equivalent to surface area. So the sea area is going to be very important. The question is how much of that fixed carbon gets sequestered. And you know what's already been said by Paul Fernandez and Tara Marshall about the standing stocks of fish suggests that actually there is a higher standing stock of carbon sitting in there, or there may well be a higher standing stock of carbon. I don't know if that's correct or not, but the more we maintain the biodiversity within that Scottish sea area, the higher that standing stock is likely to be, and the greater amount that is likely to end up actually on the seafloor and being integrated into marine sediment. So that once it gets there by a very circuitous route, I think the last thing we should be doing is trying to disturb it again. Now, whether disturbing it actually makes a huge amount of difference is something that has still got to be properly researched, as Paul Fernandez has correctly said. But we've got to be very careful. So this is about being precautionary rather than being cavalier about it. And I'm not making a specific mention here of bottom trawling, but just anything that disturbs our sediments, we have to be very careful, because actually the carbon that's there has taken a very long route to get there, and it's really quite valuable, and we've got to be very careful about it. Thank you.
Okay, a very brief supplementary from Rachel.
But could I ask Professor Fernandez if, from what he said, that he believes that enforcement measures to ensure compliance are sufficient currently? You mentioned strengthening the legislation.
Yeah, so I was referring to the management measures in many of our marine protected areas, and that has been brought into question in some recent scientific articles suggesting, for example, that trawling in some of these areas is greater than it is in out with those areas. And I understand that in addition to setting them up, then we still need to decide what activities are allowed in them. And
For example, if you set up an area protect harbour porpoises, which live in the middle of the city, then you needn't necessarily ban trawling if trawling doesn't affect those harbour porpoises. So that's an example where a management measure might include not a trawling gear, but might stop gill nets, for example, which are harmful to porpoises. So it is a bit of a horses for courses, but I think those negotiations are still going on with the various stakeholders, but I think that needs to be accelerated. And it has caused the international community to ask for these highly marine protected areas now, where you know all activity is banned for the most sensitive environments. So, for example, your deep water corals, which, like I say, have been protected now for almost 20 years. So, I would just suggest that the you know those management measures in some of the more recent marine protected areas be sort of considered more quickly.
Thank you. And a final word on this theme, Bill Austin, please.
Thank you. I just wanted to come back again on the work of the Scottish Blue Carbon Forum. We have led UK-wide spatial mapping of our shelf seas. We've published the first ever UK EEZ map of sedimentary carbon. So we do understand those spatial patterns. And I would like to emphasize in this discussion, I did make the point that I think we can prioritize areas for protection and we can help in this process with the narrative around blue carbon as a component of highly protected marine areas. So I think we have to see this in the balance of the full range of activities across our seas, not simply as something that's blanket or misconstrued in that way. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move on to the theme of sustainable fisheries management, and I'll ask Beatrice for her first question.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. We've heard a little about the effect of climate change on the movement of fish species, and Professor Fernandez, you indicated stocks are moving, and some stocks are doing well, with the exception of cod, which are more abundant in the northern North Sea. I mean, I'm told by fishermen that there is abundant cod on the fishing grounds, and you'll be aware of the concern in the fishing industry about the quality of scientific advice, both the at-sea data gathering that feeds into the annual ICES assessments and ultimately to the total allowable catches. So, I just lost my place there. ICES says itself that it's willing to engage with the fishing industry to improve data collection and the way that data is interpreted, and that's good, but that takes time and possibly years. But in the meantime, North Sea demersal fisheries are a mixed fisheries, with cod being caught at the same time as several other species during typical fishing operations. So you have a situation of acute shortage of cod quota in a situation of cod abundance, which restricts the fleet's capacity to catch species for which it does have quota. So could you say a bit more on how climate change is changing the distribution and abundance of stocks and how this impacts on the scientific evidence, which in turn impacts on the total allowable catches?
Can we maybe start with Dr. Marshall, please?
Much for that very detailed question that encompasses a lot of things. And your answer is to how the climate change is impacting our stock assessments and the data that's going in. I think that there is questions in the Scottish fishing industry about whether the information generated by standard research vessel surveys, for example, are adequately capturing the distribution. There's also open questions about the population structure, for example, whether or not the West Coast cod and the North Sea cod are should be considered as a single stock, like haddock recently was combined. So I would say that there is progress ongoing on that. There's benchmarking exercises that are going on with Marine Scotland, with the industry, and with the available scientists. So they're discussing these aspects of the cod stock in Scotland right at the moment. You can appreciate that fish stocks are a very dynamic system, so they are going to change by climate change or other factors all the time. So you're continuously updating your understanding. And as you rightly point out, that requires accurate data. The industry has a role to play in contributing to the data acquisition on fisheries. We've got a good example in Scotland of the pelagic fishing industry, where a self-sampling program has been run by the pelagic industry, and that information they gather on board fishing vessels enters directly into the assessment process. So it sharpens our sort of real-time understanding of what's going on in the stock. The demersal sector that includes species like cod and haddock and monkfish are a little behind the curve. They're a more complicated fishery. There's more vessels. There's more gear types. But I think some coordination of industry interest and effort in feeding data in so that scientists and industry can jointly get the benefit of their own data. And we have a project on the west coast of Scotland for bycatch avoidance, where the industry is doing exactly that in real time for their own benefit in avoiding bycatch of unwanted species like cod. It's possible. It requires greater trust between industry, government to build those bridges and those conversations. But I really think that that's a very positive solution going forward.
Thank you for that. I think that's an important point about the bycatch and industry and scientists working together. Is there anybody else who wanted to come in on that point? I don't see any hands up. Oh, Professor Fernandez.
Yeah, I'll just make the point about cod in particular, and I think I alluded to this earlier, I mean, cod is a very similar animal to hake. They both are sort of piscivorous. They both feed on fish. And in the northern North Sea and the west of Scotland, we've seen a massive increase in hake populations. Now there's as much hake and cod combined as there was 30 years ago of cod and hake combined, whereas in 30 years ago, cod was dominant. And that might be a climate signal, but if we look back to the 1940s and 50s, we had similar amounts of hake. And so it's just come back, and that's as a result of these management changes I mentioned earlier. So it is difficult to sort of tease out the effects of climate and the big changes that we've had in management over the last 20 years, which have improved the situation.
Yeah, so it's a combination of management and climate change.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Thank you. Can I now move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton?
Actually, it's on a supplementary to Beatrice's question there about to Dr. Marshall. Do you agree with the Scottish White Fish Producers Association, who would like to see an independent panel to assess the International Council for Exploration for sea numbers?
The Scottish Whitefish Producers Association has long been involved in the delivery of sustainable management in Scottish fisheries. And so they've been at the table, they've been to the scientific working groups. They have a very strong insight. That said, I think the levels of scientific scrutiny applied to ICES advice is extraordinarily high. You know, it goes through various layers of committees. The very upper layer of committee include international scientists who work in the field of stock assessment. Scientists are a very critical lot. We subject our own work to a high level of scrutiny. So I have also the highest regards. But you bump up against the limits of knowledge given the limited data availability that we have. And so I think we work towards solutions over time, but I'm not sure that another step is necessarily the most optimal solution to the current existing problem. There's actually a shortage, a global shortage of expertise in this area, right? It's hard to get people with the exact quantitative understanding of the models that underpin the assessment and the biology that's impacting the stock. So it's hard work, very hard work. A lot of hard work goes into our current system.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Susan to make comment, then Ian Boyd, then I'm going to move on to a question from Karen.
Yes, thank you. I just want to broaden, if I may, the bycatch issue. So in terms of our seabird species, there's many of our auk species, our razorbills, common guillemots, Atlantic puffins, which are also impacted by surface bycatch and also by pelagic bycatch. And so I think it's just really important in terms of looking at the threats and the mitigation of those threats in the round from climate change to actual activities which are taking place in the sea, that we do take approaches which monitor those impacts. We look at the mitigation, the different techniques which can be used. We trial those and we learn from those and use that to feed into, again, into that marine spatial planning and the decision making there. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ian Boyd.
Thank you very much. I'm going to be slightly critical here of the scientific system. You may find that difficult coming from a scientist, but work within quite a narrow paradigm, a scientific paradigm, where we do single species stock assessments. They are kind of married into a sort of multi-species process, but we do single species stock assessments for multi-species fisheries. And that the two things don't fit, really. The single species stock assessment works quite well for things like mackerel because it is fundamentally a single species type fishery. But where you get multi-species fisheries, there is probably a different way of working. ICES has worked very much under the single species stock assessment paradigm for a very, very long time. And I think it has trouble thinking outside that box. And what I would like to see is new science in this area. And there is new science. There's new ways of looking at stock assessments, which are much more multi-species and which look at the whole of the community system, so that fishermen, rather than going out and sampling from particular stocks, because they've got quota in those stocks, would have a community quota, which would perhaps solve some of the problems. Although I think, to be frank, the fishing industry just wants to take more fish. I don't think it would necessarily provide them with more fish. It would just make it rather easier for them to exploit the stocks as they are presented to them by the ecology of the system. Thank you.
Thank you. And now move to Karen for some further questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I'm sure I don't need to stress how much coastal communities depend on fish for their food and livelihoods, and how imperative it is that we get local fishing industry on board when it comes to protecting the marine environment for future of fisheries, to ensure high catches and healthy populations, amongst other objectives. So I'd like to ask if there's needed a greater level of engagement with scientists, managers and stakeholders to steer the process. Is this essential to the successful development of, say, harvest strategies? And if they agree, how do the panel see this being implemented, particularly in developing relationships and trust? And what sustainable incentives could there be for the industry?
Could I bring in Dr. Marshall first, please?
Yes. Thank you very much for another excellent question. And I couldn't agree with you more in the need for engaging with communities. I could answer this question in a multiple number of ways, but I'll try and be brief. Over the past years, there's been a real shift to engaging stakeholders in the conversations about fisheries management. When we were part of the European Union, for example, Aberdeen was home to the Regional Advisory Council that provided a sort of council whereby stakeholders came together to discuss fishing management. And it was learning the skills to do that type of conversation, to develop consensus was really important. And now that we've left the EU, I think we can build on that perspective of having a variety of people at the table, including our communities, and develop mechanisms for that. I think the industry very much wants to step up to the plate, as do the other stakeholder groups, for example, environmental NGOs. We just need a mechanism and a forum to evolve for our post-common fisheries policy lifetime. So I think that's a great suggestion. I would also say that you also framed it in the way of joining up policy agendas. For example, delivering sustainable fisheries, as well as healthy communities, as well as a nutritious food that has positive impacts for health. And I think that joining up of policy objectives in that area would be very fruitful, because I think we can define win-wins by having those types of multi-stakeholder conversations.
Professor Fernandez.
Yeah, so I think one of the ways to engage stakeholders more in the process is to give them opportunities to contribute to some of the science. And a perfect example of that is the anglerfish stock, which is one of our most valuable resources. And for the last 15 years, the industry has been directly involved with surveying anglerfish, and the advice is based on the results of those surveys. And as a result, that component of the industry doesn't question the science coming out of that exercise. And when quotas went down for anglerfish, they were quite happy. Now, in contrast to the cod situation, where they have less influence, and the science is suggesting that there is less cod, particularly in the southern North Sea, and the whole picture is a bit more complicated. They have questioning that advice, but that is the only one where they are have major concerns. And if you think about all the other species I mentioned, mackerel, nephrops, which is Scottish langoustine, haddock, herring, hake, whiting, saithe, megrim, ling, plaice, these are our sort of highest, most valuable resources, and they're all doing rather well. Cod is the only exception, and cod is the only one they're questioning. And the questions are possibly valid, but they're complicated because of the issues we mentioned earlier in relation to competition with hake and movements of the population to the north, etc. But if they could get involved, as was the case with the anglerfish, then that, I think, would help.
Thank you very much. And I've got a very brief supplementary, just on clarification from Jim Fairley.
Yeah, this is directly to yourself, Professor Fernandez. It's maybe a nerdy question because I know absolutely nothing about fisheries. You're saying that there's been a large increase in hake while there's been a huge decrease in cod. From the debates I'm listening to, that's disputed. But are the hake swimming in the same waters as the cod? And if that's the case, why are their numbers going up? And why are cod numbers, according to the scientists, going down?
It's a good question, but one of the main reasons that hake numbers are going up is because, like many stocks for years, they were overexploited, and we've reduced the fishing pressure on hake, and it's rebounded. So the hake population has exploded. It's 5 times now greater than it was 20 years ago. And when a population expands like that, as we saw, for example, with mackerel, was the same, but 10 years ago it expanded, it expands its range. It moves into bigger areas. And it's returned to the North Sea because in the 1950s, as I say, catches, we don't have assessments from that time, but in the 1950s, there was lots of hake. There were large catches of hake in the North Sea. And it's just come back to that situation. And it could be the case that it is outcompeting cod. We don't know that for sure. But it is interesting to note that the quantities, combined quantities of hake and cod in the northern North Sea and the west of Scotland are pretty similar to what they were 30 or 40 years ago, but they just switched.
Okay, I think you just actually answered the question I was going to ask you, is are the hake pushing the cod out?
It's hard to say that, but they are in places where the cod are no longer there, yes.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. But we're now going to move on to the theme of marine protection and enhancement, and we'll kick off with Ariane.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you, panel, for this very brilliant and interesting session this morning. My understanding is that while the Scottish Government states that 37% of our seas are protected under MPAs, only 1% are fully protected as no-take zones, and a further 5% is banned to trawl and dredge. In that light, I'd like to ask your thoughts. I've got a couple of questions here. I'd like to ask your thoughts on to what extent Scotland's network of marine protected areas is fully developed, enough to effectively support the functioning of marine ecosystems, and if not, what might need to happen to complete this network? And then I'll come back with another question.
Is there any particular you would like to address the question to?
Yes, I'll start with Professor Bill Austin.
Thank you. I'd like to answer this question in the context of our coastal seas in particular. And I think, just reflect on the notions of connected land to sea systems. I think this is an area that we do need to develop in terms of our thinking about marine protection. So I think that joined up thinking is necessary for some of these coastal MPAs. In terms of, enhanced MPA networks, then I think the connectivity between these protected areas is an area that I understand would benefit from more thought in terms of how we make these systems work. We've heard about climate change driving range changes. So we need these protected areas to be connected so that they can accommodate some of these long-term drivers. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I also hear from Professor Ian Boyd?
Thank you. I think the question as to how much of a marine, how many marine protected areas we need and what the total area is and how they should be connected is an extraordinarily difficult one to answer. It's not very well evidenced, but roughly a third is kind of thought of as being the sort of amount that you need to protect. However, in the context of the marine system, we do tend to take a very We're terrestrial animals. We take a terrestrial view of the marine environment, and we think that by putting lines on maps, we can create protected areas in the same way as we might do with nature reserves or whatever it might be on land. And it's not really quite the same. The marine system is highly dynamic. In other words, the water flows around and things move over much greater distances. Pollutants get sloshed around. Noise moves at extreme speeds. So protecting areas in the marine system is actually quite different from the terrestrial system. And in that sense, I have a particular view about this, that we need to have overall protections within the marine environment. They are much more important than area-based protections. Area-based protections are important, but overall protections, in other words, reducing overall fisheries impacts, for example, which has been described earlier on, has been probably the biggest step forward that I've heard in my lifetime in terms of progress with protecting the marine environment. So there is a danger that we focus in on area-based protection as the solution, when in fact in a marine context, it would be much better to look at a whole regional-wide protection rather than area-based protection, because I think you'll get more bang for the buck for that.
Thank you for that. Would you just take that a little bit further? So would you say that something like reintroducing the inshore limit, the 3 mile inshore limit, would be a good way forward to protect our fisheries and marine biodiversity?
Well, I mean, I wouldn't specifically want to comment on that, because I don't know what the evidence would be, but certainly our coastal areas are our most pressurised areas. There's no doubt about that at all. And if we were to protect that immediate area, and particularly the East Coast estuary areas, we'd be doing ourselves a fantastic favour.
Thank you for that. And I've got a follow-on question, and I think I'm going to stay with you, Professor Boyd. So the Marine Scotland Act 2010 seeks to promote the enhancement of marine protected areas in addition to their protection. So enhancement in addition to their protection. And I'd like to ask you to what extent enhancement has been achieved under this framework and what additional policies we might need to have in place. That, you know, are there things that are missing from that?
Well, I think I'll probably go back to what I said before, in that, my view is that enhancement should be general region-wide enhancement rather more than enhancement of the marine protected areas. But I think the marine protected areas are a slight misnomer. They're semi-protected areas a lot of the time. They're protected from some things and not other things. I think that there has been progress. I mean, I think that we've already heard of evidence that there's been progress. Whether that's fast enough is another question, and that's a value judgment that needs to be made. I'm not sufficiently well up on what Nature Scot has been doing, for example, with respect to monitoring and measuring the progress that has been made. But they would be able to answer that. But the reality is that we need to be able to measure the progress we're making. And actually, in general, in the marine environment, we struggle to do that. So we struggle to evidence the fact that actually we're making a difference.
Thank you for that. And could I just see if anybody else would like to come in on that question around enhancement?
No. Okay, I'm just a slight. Oh, well, I think Bill indicated. Bill, do you want to come in?
And Susan.
Yeah, thank you. Just on enhancement, you know, I think one of the exciting areas we've covered already is towards climate mitigation. And, you know, there are these emerging opportunities which I think we need to keep an eye on. The focus, I think, has often been on biodiversity. I would make that point. I saw two other colleagues raise their hands there as well, Chair.
Susan, would you like to come in briefly?
Yes, just to emphasise, I mean, marine protected areas, yes, good for biodiversity, but also good in terms of food supply and carbon storage. They are one part of the system for managing the marine environment, and it's important that they're set in the context of the wider marine spatial plans, regional plans. I think the other point is just on the restoration point. We are seeing more moves now towards actual practical restoration projects in the marine environment, whether that's oyster beds, mussel beds, or seagrass meadows. And I think those are important steps which require public and private financing now, and to learn from actually doing that restoration, to build the science from actually doing the restoration.
Thank you. Was there anybody else who wanted to come in on that? No? Okay, very briefly to close this theme. Obviously, regional marine planning areas can play a big part in this, and we see some great examples up in Shetland. But part of that is ensuring we get the stakeholders around the table to ensure sustainable fisheries and so on. Can I ask Dr. Marshall whether she thinks inshore fishery groups are well enough resourced to ensure we do get the best outcomes when we look at marine protection, but also sustainable fisheries?
Yeah, inshore fisheries groups have become increasingly active, both in England as well as Scotland. And I think there's much, a really important role they can play, because those inshore fisheries, they tend to have a lot of vessels. So there are a lot of people that partake in those fisheries, unlike the offshore fisheries. So they're really important, but they're also complex because there are so many people. And there are issues that they need to tackle. They are also extremely data limited. Scotland has one project run out of this, out of St. Andrews, called the Scottish Inshore Fisheries Data Collection, CIFIDS. It's well supported. It's supporting the inshore shellfish industry, and they're trying to get skippers to report data that can be used to monitor the status of the inshore stocks. So I think those groups are going to play an increasingly important role. They have been funded by Marine Scotland, and they should continue to get funding.
Great. Well, that takes us very easily on to our next theme, which is data collection, data gaps and research needs. And can I ask Jenny to kick off the question?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. It's been really interesting. I represent a West Coast constituency, so as you know, Finlay started questions with asking about Scotland and the rest of the world, I'm quite interested to delve in a bit to the East Coast, West Coast differences in Scotland. Last week, I visited SAMHS just north of Oban and learnt about the research that they are doing, and found and got introduced to a robotic that was about to head off from there all the way up to Iceland to learn about the changes in water, and it was sending back data real time. So I'm interested, as well as the differences between East and West, to find out about the data that's currently being collected to contribute to assessments on the health of the marine environment, and where there might be some gaps in that collection, and where more research is required. And also, how do we, I think Dr. Marshall talked about the limited amount of scientists, how we're growing the scientist population through the various universities that are represented here, but also SAMHS itself. So if I start with Professor Bill Austin there, I think.
Thank you. I should let you know that I am a visiting professor at SAMHS, so I'm delighted that you visited and seen those amazing things that they're doing there. I think I would pick up on the point that was made about restoration and learning as we go along with the science. I think these two things can go hand in hand. And my interest, as you've realised, is in blue carbon, this emerging area for climate mitigation, adaptation. I think there's a great opportunity to understand how management of our seas, I'm not sure how well we manage our seas, if we do even manage our seas at the moment, and certainly protection, can deliver these sorts of benefits. And I think this is where the really exciting research lies. So of course, that's something I would want to encourage, but also the evidence base that we've discussed. You know, what are what is the evidence that can underpin the policies that we need in this area? So for climate mitigation, the global challenges, I think, you know, protection, restoration, and the benefits that really do flow from this are the things that we really need to improve our understanding of those. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Professor Ian Boyd?
Yes, I think that we are always very challenged by monitoring progress in the marine system. It's data poor relative to what we have to deal with in the terrestrial system, for example, because not only is it very big, it's very remote, and it's expensive to get there. So what you witness in terms of the robotics from SAMHS, which is wonderful, but is becoming actually standard practice now in the marine system, is the way that science is going. It's moving towards relatively low cost robotic systems to collect very large amounts of data relatively quickly. But there are still areas of the marine system that do require people to get on ships and to go out there and actually do the sampling. We haven't really got robotic technology suitable for that. You know, whatever happens, we're going to be pretty challenged. So there are some pretty large data gaps, actually. And, you know, we've talked quite a lot in this session about fisheries. And, you know, I think the fisheries scientists do a fantastic job. But the reality is that they are dealing with quite what we call quite sparse data sets a lot of the time. And they're making a lot of inferences based on those data sets. It's the same with sampling the benthic system. You know, it's a massive area. And getting to the benthic system, in other words, the sediments at the bottom of the sea, is a major logistic job in itself. So I think that what I would try to get over from this is that we need to continue in Scotland to invest in the kind of science and the kind of infrastructure that you saw at SAMS. My view is that given the importance of the marine system in Scotland and the economic importance and also the cultural welfare and environmental importance of the marine system, we don't invest nearly enough in our marine science capabilities. And going back to some of the earlier discussions about involving communities in that, I think our coastal communities could be much, much more involved in that. I think our fishing industry could be much more involved in it because they've got ships that are going out there that are doing one thing, they're fishing, but they could be doing multiple things. And we're nowhere near as intelligent as we need to be in order to be able to become much, much more informed about our marine environment to the same extent as we might be informed about our terrestrial system, our mountains, our moorlands and things like that. And we have relative little knowledge compared with our terrestrial system. Thank you.
OK, thank you. And Dr. Tara Marshall?
I think there are data gaps, but there's also accessibility of data that is an issue. There's a lot of data being collected that we simply cannot get at for scientific purposes. I could give you several examples, but I'll give you one that is a bugbear of mine, and it's environmental impact assessments that people who are doing things like decommissioning oil rigs and things, they all run out and do sediment surveys. They do taxonomic work for the benthic invertebrates, and those data are regarded as a commercial property and are inaccessible. And it's the type of data that we can't fund research vessels to go out and collect. So I think it would be fantastic if the industries and users of the marine environment are required to supply data. And there's the concept of the Internet of Marine Things. And that's this great vision of a future where we've got data of all different types coming in to paint a picture of the health of our marine ecosystems. So everybody needs to step up and contribute their data. So I'm just making the point that accessibility and transparency would be a great result going forward.
Thank you, Dr. Marshall. I think due to time constraints, I'll pass that to the chair. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. We're really up against the clock here, so I'm going to move finally to Rachel Hamilton on COP, and I would appreciate if you could keep your responses as brief as possible. Thank you, Rachel.
So I'd like to ask the panel what their takeaways are from Ocean Action Day and COP26. I'd also like to ask how the World Bank Fund, the Pro Blue Fund of $6 million, will help Scotland and what projects they'd like to see put forward. And finally, on the 30 by 30 commitment to protect 30% of global seas and drive an increase in biodiversity, what kind of marine environment policies would you like to see that run parallel to that 30-30 commitment? I'll start with Paul Fernandes, please.
Gosh, that's a big question. So some of the existing problems in the area of fisheries, for example, relate to some of your questions. So we still don't know how to deal with the problem of bycatch and discards. So that's something that I would look
to. Sorry, can you repeat that? Could you repeat that?
Yes. Some of the problems of bycatch and discarding at sea from the fishing industry, there are no solutions to that. We need to deal with that. Tara has a good project on the west of Scotland looking at stakeholder involvement for detecting hotspots. and there are some technical solutions which we are also working on. And I would look to the MASTS organisation, which Ian Boyd set up, to help with the analysis of a lot of these data, and to Marine Scotland Science to provide more resources for their increasing needs to not only look at fisheries, aquaculture, but also licensing and marine strategy framework directive related issues of the whole marine environment. And as for the 30 by 30, just to make the point that, you know, in terms of fisheries management, that probably won't help. It will be very specific to particular conservation needs for biodiversity, which is very relevant. But there are other tools we can use to enhance our fisheries that are more effective than just area management.
Convener, I can't see who's coming in and who has their hand up.
Maybe we'll stick on the fisheries. Could we bring in Dr. Marshall?
And I'm going to limit it to fisheries science going forward in Scotland. Finlay Carson will know I'm a big advocate of a concept called co-management. So that is referring to a system where, in particular, the fishing industry is given greater responsibility, for example, for contributing, collecting, and analyzing their own data. And they step up to the plate. The version of co-management, as it was expressed in the Future of Fisheries Management document, it was very preliminary, very partial. It was cast as people sitting around a table. But real, actual co-management is co-management, that you have responsibility and that there's some power-sharing arrangements. I think that creates flexibility for the industry, but it also requires greater transparency of the industry. So I think that's a really positive thing to imagine what it would be like in future for us to use co-management approaches in a very real, not just lip service way going forward.
Thank you. Can we go to Susan, Ian, and then Bill?
Yep.
Yes, thank you for that. A range of issues in there. I think if we look at some of the commitments and the policies which need to be in place, we have a lot of the right policies. We have a lot of the right frameworks for the management of the marine environment. And I think the real challenge for us is the lack of pace that we have in terms of taking those actually into implementation. And so we need to, you know, pull the data together more quickly to help inform the translation of those strategies into plans. And I think we need to start seeing some of those measures implemented, whether it's measures for protection within our marine protected areas or in terms of our wider marine spatial planning. The other thing is, I think, that in terms of some of the sort of financial investments that we're seeing from World Bank, from other private investors, I think there is a huge opportunity for that investment to go into the restoration of blue carbon habitats. And I think that's a shift that we need to see, a kind of upscaling in terms of the amount of financial investment there.
Thank you. And Ian.
I think the emphasis at COP on the oceans is obviously to be welcomed. I think the only final point I would make, and this refers to 30-30 and all sorts of other things that we've talked about, is that the oceans are highly dynamic. They've always been changing through time, and they will continue to change. The really important thing is that we try to understand better how they're going to change in future and what our role is in that. Trying to preserve the oceans and the marine system in one particular state is doomed to failure. It will not happen because nature will not allow it to happen. What we need to do is be adaptable, and I think people have mentioned this. We need to put things in place, we need to try them, we need to see how the system responds to them. The whole fisheries management process is part of that story. And we need to learn from that and move on. That's about an attitude of mind, and it's about philosophy as much as anything else, which is actually slightly different to what we experience in the terrestrial environment, where we expect more long-term consistency. than we would in most parts of the marine environment. Thank you.
Last but not least, Bill Austin.
Thank you. Yes, I spoke earlier about the optimism to see the ocean climate nexus growing at COP26, and I think that will continue. I'm really encouraged to see the oceans as part of a new framework for nature-based solutions, where there are outcomes for climate, for people, and for biodiversity. And I think this challenges us to rethink our oceans. I think key here will be developing the appropriate pipelines. So what we wish for requires pipelines to look at investment opportunities. And I think this point about potential stakeholder engagement, you know, is critical. And some of these areas are challenging and do require this. So that would be my final observation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very unfortunately, we've come to the end of this session, but I very much appreciate the fascinating evidence that you provided this morning. I will now briefly suspend for a changeover in witnesses. Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone, and a welcome to our meeting, our second panel, who will be discussing the terrestrial environment. And with us this morning, we have Dr. Helena Black, Honorary Associate, and Professor Rob Brooker, Head of Ecological Science at the James Hutton Institute. Professor Mark Metzger, I hope I pronounced that properly, Chair in Environment and Society at the University of Edinburgh, and Professor Pete Smith, Chair in Plant and Science and Soil Science from the University of Aberdeen. I'm going to kick off here with a statement. For terrestrial and freshwater ecosystems, land use changes have had the largest relative negative impact on nature since 1970, followed by direct exploitation, in particular over-exploitation of animals, plants and other organisms, mainly via harvesting, logging, hunting and fishing. So can I ask whether that that level of pressure is the same in Scotland as globally, and whether the impacts are likely to affect Scotland in different ways than globally. And can I start by asking Professor Brooker to come in and kick us off, please?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. The impacts, are those the key drivers of change in Scotland as well as globally? And I think the answer to that question is yes. So we do see at Scottish level continuing declines in biodiversity as a result of land use change. And then the effects of, for example, climate change are fitting in around the patterns that those land use change impacts are having. So we're seeing continuing declines, in particular in some of the more intensively managed land that we have in Scotland, in the number and the distribution of species. But we're also in the particularly temperature-sensitive environments, such as mountain systems. That's where we're seeing the large and most immediate impacts of climate change. So where the land use pressure is perhaps lower and those organisms are more heavily regulated by temperature, that's where it's easier and clearer to see the land use change impact. So a really nice example are snow beds in Scottish mountain systems. And there was mentioned in the papers recently of the Sphinx snow bed in Brer Rick, and that's disappeared again. So those organisms that are associated with those very cold systems are dropping away. So are they affecting Scotland in different ways? In terms of the mechanisms and processes, no. I think what might be different in Scotland is the balance of those effects. So that in some countries, obviously, where there's been less land use change historically, there's a larger immediate impact of species loss because of land use change, whereas in Scotland, the issues are ongoing decline, fragmentation of habitat, and other factors were perhaps more obvious in different environments, such as mountain systems, which are more susceptible to climate change, or freshwater systems, which are more susceptible to pollution.
Okay, thank you. And Helena Black.
Morning. Hi there. So a couple of things I'd like to draw on, following on from Rob. In the context, and I'll focus on soils because I'm a soil scientist, in relation to soils and in our environment, I think it'd be fair to say that the biggest changes really happened before the 1970s. They've gone on for centuries as we have changed our land use. So really what we're looking on in terms of post-1970 is a focus on management and management intensity. And for soils, it's not just about management. It's about the combination of a number of stressors. Management intensity, management type, atmospheric pollution. It's a combination of things that have actually led to soils degradation and effects on biodiversity in the environments and the habitats where you've got soils. Another thing I'd also like to point out in terms of soil habitats and degradation is from the 1970s is actually the losses from development. Significant losses to the actual land area of soils under development, which has implications for the resource that we've got going forward. And what I would say and reflect to that, looking at globally, what we see happening in Scotland is no different than is happening elsewhere in the world. There's recognition that globally soils are degraded from all these different pressures. And the State of Scotland Soils Report that was published in 2011, if I remember rightly, has a really good illustration of these different threats and risks and what they mean for Scotland. But that is translated globally as well. Okay.
Move on to Mark.
Yes, I mean, I think the previous two responses are really appropriate. Maybe one thing to add is that there are differences in different parts of Scotland. So the more extensively managed systems versus the intensive systems and the more towards the East Coast. The other thing maybe to reflect on is the role of land ownership in Scotland, which is quite different from many parts of the world, or certainly many parts of the northwestern world. And that reflects on how land is used and also how quickly changes in land use can be implemented. And in some ways, a concentrated land ownership has meant that large changes could happen very quickly. And we've seen that in the past. And I think we're also seeing that right now and potentially into the future. Thinking of forestry and things like rewilding. But I don't think I have too much else to add at this point.
Thank you. And finally, in this one, Professor Peter Smith.
Yeah, so one of the biggest legacy effects from the 1970s and 1980s is the peatland planting with production forestry, which was there were tax breaks given for planted production forestry on peatlands. And that was disastrous. And we're just coming to terms with that now. It's increased our emissions greatly from peatlands, increased the degradation of those peatlands. And we're now working out what to do, you know, whether we remove the trees, whether we leave the trees, what we do with that forestry. But that was a dumb decision that was made a few decades ago, which has legacy effects that we're seeing today.
Thank you. I'll move to a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Actually, Professor Smith, on that very point, I'm keen to know, look into the future, whether some of those mistakes are reversible. Other questions, briefly, I'll touch on that in terms of what we mean by biodiversity intactness. But just helpfully, you raised the very point I was going to ask about, which is, are some of those decisions... I won't mention prominent broadcasters that invested in these trees in the 1980s, but are some of these decisions reversible?
So, in a word, yes. So, what the main issue? Well, 80% of our peatlands are degraded. They're a natural resource for Scotland, which is very important. 80% are degraded, and they can be restored. And it's largely a matter of raising the water table. And in some cases, helping the vegetation, the peat-forming species, the sphagnum mosses, to come back. So it can be dealt with, and the Peatland Action Programme is embarking upon that sort of peatland restoration. More specifically, on the afforested peatlands, there are debates about whether it's better to remove the trees or to just re-wet the peatlands. And just allow the trees to remain. And there's still some open debate about that, whether you cause more damage going on in harvesting or whether you just leave them, abandon the timber and just let it re-wet by raising the water table. But in a word, it can be restored. And we have to do more. I think, you know, the Committee on Climate Change recommends that we should restore at least 80% of our peatlands. I think the target should be 100% by 2050. And that will require stepping up our peatland action programme, our peatland restoration programme. And we'll require much more resource. We should regard this as at the same level of resource required for large infrastructure projects, such as rail and road sort of infrastructure projects. That's the sort of resource that we should be throwing at the issue, because it's critical for us meeting our net zero targets and also for restoring biodiversity.
And just finally and briefly, I think it's briefly, perhaps for Professor Smith again, we've got in our debate around the environment, we now factor in questions around biodiversity intactness. Now, Scotland seems to be doing a bit better than some places in the UK on that score, but not as well as other places perhaps in Europe. But what do you, and others may want to chip in, what do you understand by biodiversity intactness? Obviously, in parts of Scotland, like the Highlands and Islands, for very good historical reasons, there is a slight recoil from the word wilderness. So what is biodiversity intactness, and how do you reconcile that with attempts to populate or repopulate fragile areas?
I use the biodiversity index in my work. There are others on the call, particularly Rob Brooker knows far more about this than I do, so I'll defer to him for an answer on that one.
Is he coming in? Rob?
I'm still muted. Can you hear me? Okay, thanks. So the Biodiversity Intactness Index is something which is specifically set out as the proportion of biodiversity that remains after human impact. So I think the point that's made in the work that was done by the Natural History Museum is that it incorporates these big historical changes away from what the natural systems would look like. And so for highly developed countries that have had large populations for a long period, such as the nations in the UK, our biodiversity intactness is substantially impacted by the long history of land management that we've got. And so other countries that have not had that intensive and spread land management have a lower level of impact, and so a score higher in the biodiversity intactness index. So we do have a substantially reduced biodiversity relative to what we could have, but we do have pockets of biodiversity that are very high and very important. And we could increase the biodiversity throughout the landscape. One of the major challenges is integrating conservation with the other land use needs that we have at the moment. And I think that's something that is highlighted by a lot of the discussion at COP around nature-based solutions, but that may be something that we come on to in a bit.
Thank you. On the back of the a question, you know, the biodiversity intactness is a very worrying statistic when you look at it. But we're very much focused on carbon at the moment and reducing our carbon dioxide and whatever. And we hear about net zero all the time. Are we addressing the biodiversity crisis in the way we should? Should we attack the biodiversity crisis first and climate will look after itself, or the other way around? Have we got the emphasis in Scotland right? Because our ability to change the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is limited by the size of our country, whereas the biodiversity loss in Scotland is pretty dramatic. Are we focusing in the right area? And could I maybe ask Dr. Black to kick off?
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Thank you. So, to be honest, personally, from my point of view, I don't think we should look at them as separate issues. We have an opportunity here to really have a win-win with both. One of the things that's quite clear from the evidence is that most of our habitats and land uses in Scotland could gain more carbon and help in terms of mitigating climate change and also in terms of adapting to climate change. And fundamentally, carbon is the food source for most of our habitats. And actually, if you work to restore carbon in habitats, you work to restore them for biodiversity as well. But I really do think that we need to move away from looking at the two separate items. And this is really fundamental to looking at nature-based solutions as well, that you're not looking at an ecosystem for one thing it might deliver, which is carbon or biodiversity, but you're saying we want healthy ecosystems that are actually going to sustain biodiversity and contribute to climate. Happy to move on, or if there's anything else you'd like to ask me.
Thank you very much. I think that takes us smoothly on to our second theme, which is on peatlands and soils. And can I ask Ariane to ask the first question, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for joining us. We've kind of already started to get into peatland. Obviously, it's clearly a very important part of our terrestrial response to climate and nature emergencies. So I would like to hear maybe from Professor Smith about the role of peatlands in relationship to biodiversity and climate change and the current state and the tools available to support healthy peatlands. And I'm particularly interested in, because you were talking about this massive scale, what is in place for us to really take it to that level of scale? And if you've had a chance to look at the National Planning Framework, do you think that that might be the place that we actually need to have the kind of, place this work on peatland?
Yes. So 80%, as I said before, 80% of our peatlands are in a somewhat or very degraded state. So we've got a lot of work to do to restore them. We have a peatland action programme to restore those, but it's limited in scope and with resources. And it's also limited by practical constraints, such as the availability of contractors to go and do the work. So we need to upskill the contractors and the people that can actually do the on-the-ground work. And it just requires more resource and more, you know, as part of a green recovery, we could upskill rural workers to provide those jobs to work in the that sector. So coming back to the protected biodiversity and hitting net zero, I think it came up in the first panel, and it's the same issue again. We employ nature-based solutions wherever we can, which co-deliver to climate change mitigation and adaptation and biodiversity and support people also. So that means protecting our existing high carbon ecosystems and high biodiversity ecosystems, our pristine peatlands, restoring those 80% that aren't in pristine condition, and on other parts of the land, better managing them and creating novel ecosystems, particularly in urban environments, which can provide those benefits to nature, to biodiversity, nature, and to climate change. So that's really the focus should be on co-delivering to biodiversity and climate change, and also to developing and supporting sustainable rural livelihoods by, for example, creating jobs in rural sectors, which can support the expansion of things like woodland expansion and peatland restoration.
Thank you for that. And then I'd like to go on to ask Dr. Helena Black, similar question, but actually focusing on non-peat soils. So, what are the tools available to support healthy soils, and what do we need to be doing with non-peat soils in terms of our response to the biodiversity and climate emergencies?
So I'll start with the what do we need to be doing, and actually it's not really that dissimilar to what we need to be doing for peatlands and native systems. There is huge potential to store carbon in agricultural soils, and there's an opportunity there to improve the health of the soils by taking that joint action in terms of managing for the climate, but also managing for biodiversity and managing for productivity. And I'll come back to that explicitly. In terms of tools, I think at the moment there are a lot of tools out there in terms of agricultural soils, in terms of advising farmers on what to do for productivity. So managing the fertilizer inputs or managing for water quality, etc. But where there still remains a gap is what are the tools that really provide information on a healthy soil? So there are companies out there that are now offering analyses of soil health, for example. But the challenge with those at the moment is, what does it actually mean to an individual farmer in an individual location with distinct soil types and distinct management practices? And the gap there really is in translating what we know from research in terms of what makes a healthy soil and providing that in a way that farmers can understand, so they can actually alter their management to improve healthy soils. So to me, it's this transfer of knowledge between research and practice that is really we're needing to develop. So coming back to that, we're very lucky in Scotland that our agricultural soils are very healthy, but they're actually, because they are agricultural soils, have a huge potential to increase carbon stores and reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The challenge going forward there, again, is tools about information to farmers about how they reduce their inorganic inputs into soils, which are a major contributor to the greenhouse gas emissions and are derived from fossil fuels, so they're getting more and more expensive. But how do they move away from reliance on things like inorganic fertiliser and start to work more with the biodiversity that they actually have in their soils that provide the carbon storage, provide the nutrient dynamics? And it's that fundamental shift that we're going to have to enable. There's a lot of research out there. A lot of what we need to do is actually plug that information gap to make it applicable in the farmer's field.
I've got a supplementary, and then Rachel has on this topic. You know, we have seen some farms, organic farms, from 25 years ago. It's taken 25 years to get to a point where they've removed nearly all non-organic fertilisers or nitrogen and whatever, and the soil has regenerated to such a point where the yields and whatever are now delivering a sustainable, economically, and both biodiversity, in terms of biodiversity. So it's taken 25 years. Has any work been done to look at and assess the condition of Scotland's soils to give a timescale of where, I suppose you could say, where the soils can have a just transition from artificial fertilisers to organic fertilisers? Because we have got targets. So we've got a target to become net zero by 2045. Agriculture's got a big role to play in that. What scientific work has been done to assess how long it will take from the soils in the condition they are today to start delivering in the future? So again, that might be for Dr. Black again.
I'll kick it off, but I probably will like to hand over to Pete, actually, once I've said a few of my things. So we're very lucky in Scotland that we have a wealth of what I call modelling capacity that allows us to look at how our systems might change over time. And really, if we're going to look to how long it might take for our farming systems to move to another status, i.e. move away from reliance on inorganic, then we've got the capacity to do that. But you've actually hit quite an interesting gap. We know a lot about transition to organic farming and how long that might take and what it means in terms of productivity. But where there is a gap there is in the intermediary, because the expectation is that we are still going to have to retain a relatively high level of productivity to maintain society. So the reliance on organic is going to have something in between where we are now and fully organic. That is definitely a modelling gap, but we have the capacity to do that. And I wonder if maybe we could hand over to Pete, because he has much more experience in the modelling side of this that could underpin this.
Yeah, Pete.
Yeah, thanks, Elena. So I think perfection, aim for perfection may be the enemy of progress. So if we're aiming for a fully organic system, then it takes a while to transition. But we could imagine a more steady transition towards more organic production through things like agroecology. So agroecology is a bit like organic production, but it doesn't have the full certification that you can't use any external inputs. So going somewhere sort of like a halfway house before we go to full organic by using, promoting and supporting more agroecological approaches would probably be the way to go, because then we could transition without that loss in productivity, and that would help farmers to learn as they go along during this transition how to cope with less inputs or agrochemicals rather than just going organic overnight.
Thank you, Peter. Rachel has a supplement on this. Can I just ask, is there any sight of any policies that might help us achieve that? Dr. Black or Pete, any policies in the pipeline?
Yeah, so in terms of policies, I must admit I'm not entirely familiar with that, but what I would say is there is increasing interest in farmers and a growing body of farmers moving towards implementing what they call regenerative practices, which are very much reflect agroecological principles. So though regenerative farming might seem like a new term, again, back down to what Pete said, it's underlined by a knowledge of agroecological evidence. And there's some interesting principles there that I think farmers can use and adopt quite easily. So minimising soil disturbance, addition of cover crops. So there's certain management practices that farmers can start to play around and adopt. But in terms of policy, I might refer to Rob or Pete, because they're probably more aware of the actual policies that are in place. But one that I might bring up now that will have implications for this is where we go in terms of managing soil carbon, because it has quite a lot of significance in terms of these practices will regenerate soil carbon, and a lot of farmers are now looking to see whether or not they can be incentivized to do that. So coming on to the next step is what's going to happen with agricultural subsidies or agricultural government policy under the new schemes, and how that will encourage people to adapt to these new management practices.
Okay, thank you. Can I briefly move, ask for Rob for response and then back to Pete, and then I'm going to move on to the supplementary.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah. So in terms of the policies, I think what Helena said about the payment mechanisms at the moment, that's really key for encouraging whether or not farmers move down that route. And my understanding is we're currently still in the sort of stability phase where the plan is put in place for Scotland following the movement away from the EU. So it's critical what the payment structures look like there. But there is a clear need within that if we're going to shift towards more sustainable farming, both for a shift towards payment for outcomes, and there's work on that at the moment. So we look to see whether or not the management practices we put in place deliver what we want. And then with respect to the indicators of soil health, we need to have those good indicators so that we can assess whether or not we're getting the outcomes that we want in terms of improvements in soil health. And we know that from recent work, there's a potential suite of indicators, and there is work under the next Scottish Government Strategic Research Programme to look at how those indicators respond to different management regimes, to see how they can be used as part of this process for seeing how farms move from standard management practice to a more sustainable practice moving forward, which could be linked to the payment mechanisms.
Thank you. And Pete, briefly.
Yes, so I think the post-cap subsidy system has a great potential to incentivise more sustainable management practices. So we can use the public money to pay for the public goods which are provided by farming. So if you change your farming in a way that provides more natural capital, that this requires more information and more calculation of the natural capital that are provided by different farming systems. For example, enhancing biodiversity, carbon storage, leisure and amenity value, air quality and improving water quality, all of these public goods that are potentially provided by farming could be valued, and an incentive system could be designed around the delivery of those public goods rather than the production that was subsidised, often uneconomic production that was subsidised under the cap. So I think this is a real opportunity for us to redesign our subsidy system to support what we want to get out of farming and how it can contribute to our net zero ambitions as well as to our biodiversity targets.
Thank you. And a supplementary on soils from Rachel.
Thank you. I think listening to this evidence and listening to farmers as well, farmers have been demonised and they are looking to be part of the solution to net zero. They're already doing such work as regenerative practice and putting in buffer zones and lots of rotational grazing and minimum tillage and all the rest of it. So I think if you look at the wider picture here, sustainable agricultural management doesn't actually have a definition. And therefore, it's very difficult for farmers who are already doing these things to articulate how they can do more. I'm listening to Dr. Black. There seems as though there is a gap. There's a gap in what farmers are meant to be doing, or their expectations, or your expectations, our expectations, the expectations of the world. And considering that 95% of agriculture relies on soil and agroecological or organic practices are not going to give us the food that we need to live healthily. So I think we're in a very difficult situation here, and I'd actually quite like to bring in Mark Miska on some comments on my sort of statement there.
No, thank you. I think you're absolutely right there, and one of the challenges is we have a farming sector waiting or already doing a lot, but also waiting to do more, but they need clarity and they need to have multi-annual support to change what they're doing make the investments or to get outside investment in. We have been waiting for a number of years now for that transition from post-cap. And my understanding is that that clarity has been postponed again for a number of years. And I don't think we really have those years to spare. So I would really encourage any signals from government that would give clarity to the sector on what is expected and how they will be supported. And I think without those signals, it would be very difficult to expect them to make more changes than they, well, of course, they can always make more changes, but to commit to substantial, large changes to their business practices without more clarity on how they will be supported to do that.
Thank you. We'll come back to sustainable agriculture management in just a second. Can I move on to Beatrice, who's got some final questions on peatland?
Thanks, Convener. Professor Smith, you indicated that 80% of Scotland's peatlands are degraded but can be restored. There's some concern about peat being dug up for the construction of wind farms and the installation of wind turbines for green energy. And I'm also aware of peatland restoration work occurring around such wind farm projects. So I wonder if you could say what the impact of wind farm building is on the biodiversity of peatlands.
Yeah, so I was involved in the wind farm carbon calculator, the development of that. And we know that if you site a wind farm on peats, the impact upon the peat, the carbon that you lose from the peat by draining it to put the base in, can outweigh the carbon benefits of the turbine. So citing wind farms on pristine peatlands doesn't seem to make much sense in terms of the carbon payback time or our net zero targets. The impact on biodiversity may be different, but the extent of the drainage around the turbine base really determines how much carbon is lost and how much you lose those peat-forming organisms. But generally speaking, if wind farms can be sited away from peatlands, for example, on mineral soils, that gives you win-win benefits in terms of providing renewable energy and also not losing the carbon. So I think we should favour that. CEPA use the and in more planning developments, the carbon, the wind farm carbon calculator tool is used, but it allows either for other areas to be restored to compensate for installing the peatlands, and it also allows for the minimisation of the area that's actually drained. Whether that happens in real life is another question. So I think it deserves more attention on where we site the wind farms, and I think we should give precedence to those that are sited on mineral soils rather than on pristine deep peats.
Just on from it, is there and it's another one for you, Pete. Is there any calculation of how much peat has been displaced by the wind farms that we currently have, and what the carbon impact has that been? And is there any obligation on local authorities when they grant planning permission to assess through the carbon wind farm carbon calculator to assess the suitability of new wind farms? Because undoubtedly through the new national planning framework there will be a push for ever more new wind farms. Do we need to play a bigger role in the planning process?
Yes. So I don't think anybody's done the calculation, but it could easily be done on the amount of carbon that's been lost on siting the peatlands, because we know the carbon content of the soils or the peats where they've been placed. So we could do those numbers, but to my knowledge, nobody has. There's already a requirement to use the wind farm carbon calculator in the planning applications, and it's often used by the wind developers and also by people opposing the developments, and they come up with different answers depending upon the extent of drainage that's put into the calculator. So I think and also the carbon payback time is only one of the considerations that local authorities will consider. They have to consider other issues, such as the creation of local jobs and generating energy, sustainable energy, for example, within the locality. So it's only one component. But I think given the importance of peats for carbon and for biodiversity, I think we should look at this again.
So is there a suggestion there might be at the moment some, the term that's often used, greenwashing by the renewable sector to say that we might be displacing peat here, but we're going to restore it somewhere else?
Actually, they could genuinely be doing that. So for the area of peatland that is affected by a wind farm, they may be investing in restoring peatlands elsewhere. But we have a finite peatland stock. And obviously, if we didn't destroy the peatlands by putting wind farms on them, we wouldn't need to restore that amount. We need to restore it anyway. We need to restore 100% of our peatlands. So given that we've got 100% of the resource that we need to restore, that's not additional. That's going to happen anyway.
Yep, thank you. That I appreciate that. We'll now move on to our next theme, which is sustainable agricultural management. Questions from Jim Fairley.
Thanks, convener, and thank you, panel. I have to say, as a former farmer, I do find some of these discussions pretty frustrating when I hear panels talking about what farmers have to do. And I'd first of all like to understand what you understand that farmers already do. And it's the point possibly that Rachel has picked up. You talked about, Dr. Helena Black, you talked about reducing the amount of fertiliser that is used. I recently went to a farm visit where they're now doing precision drilling. And what that means is a computer tells them how much, what you used to have was 300 weight of NPK splattered across the whole field. Now what they do is they go into the field, it's all done by GPS, and you'll get 400 weight there, 100 weight there, nothing there, 500 weight there. So the field is fertilised to exactly what it needs. And that gives you the maximum yield with the minimum amount of inputs, because first of all, fertiliser is very expensive. It's over £600 a tonne right now, so farmers don't want to be wasting it. There is also then the use of, and I know that it's a controversial thing, glyphosate. You spray off old grass, you eat it to the board, you spray off old grass, and then you direct drill it with a crop after it's been fertilised by livestock over a number of years. We call that regenerative farming. I just call it farming because it's been getting done for generations. So I'd like to understand where the dichotomy has come from demonising farmers for producing good quality food in a sustainable way to what they have always done. So I'd just like to get a better understanding of that. I'd start with yourself, Lena Black.
Hi, thanks for that. So I think you've highlighted something that is very important in the context of all of this, that farmers are always innovating. And sometimes we can be a bit behind the curve in terms of providing farmers with the right information. But I'd come back to a statement that you made. You said that farmers are sustainable. Now, in the context of producing crops, yes. But the context of a broader term of sustainability, you have to question whether or not we can enable farming to carry on in the way it's going, given that we have water quality issues, given that we're looking at climate change mitigation and adaptation, and given we've got losses in biodiversity. Because farming a field does not happen in isolation of the wider landscape of which that field sits. And I think that's really at the heart of what we've got to deal with going forward, if we've got to ensure that we actually bring farmers with us in this conversation about how do we have address our biodiversity losses, improve our environment, have the social gains, address climate mitigation. And I think this is where this conflict or confusion or discussion has to sit and revolve around that. So for me, I think actually a starting point is actually looking at how we define sustainable management. And what does that mean in Scotland as a society at whole? And not sustainable management for product production, not sustainable management for biodiversity, not sustainable management for climate change mitigation. But what do we mean by sustainable land use in Scotland to deliver these multiple benefits that we want and we desire? And if we have a common view of that, I think this will help a lot in the conversations going forward. But the other side of this, I think we need to reflect on is the fact that you said that prices of inorganic fertilisers are going up and up. And farmers are looking to adapt their farming systems so that they can actually maintain a farm into the future that actually can support incomes and support the farming society. And I actually don't see that there is necessarily a conflict here between this and people talking about regenerative farming, etc. It goes back to what Pete said. Every farmer is going to have to look at a transition to adapt to climate change. And in that context, the tools that are out there will also help carbon mitigation, will also help biodiversity. And I'm not saying, personally, I'm not saying that we have to expect every farmer in Scotland to become agroecological or regenerative, but there is a toolbox there that would allow every farmer in Scotland to work towards that transition. The issue here is allowing them the flexibility to do that within their own environment and coming back to what is the other things we want those farmers to do. So I agree that we have had this demonisation, but now we need to move forward and think about how we integrate the stories of climate, biodiversity, whatever. Now, can I just reflect on something that I was involved with a workshop yesterday to do with farm soil carbon credits? And one of the things we were doing was asking the 200-odd people on that workshop their views about what they want these credits to achieve. Now, I don't want to get into the credit thing, but I think what was fascinating to me was, out of those questionnaires, we were asking people about what they wanted to achieve in their farming. And the very highest point that came out of all the surveys was adapting farming to a future under climate change. Every farmer wants to achieve that, and we need to provide the tools to do that. And I think what we are seeing here is reflecting on agroecological principles can help farmers move in that transition.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Rob in because we're lucky to have two experts from the James Hutton Institute. Now, I, from my knowledge, and again gained from Aberdeen University many years ago in the soil science department there, microbiology plays a huge role in this. The microbiology, the more nitrogen, artificial nitrogen we put in, the less we rely on the microbes within the soil to fix that nitrogen. And other microbiology and other matter within the soil is very good at allowing plants to uptake nutrients and whatever. And the more artificial fertiliser put on, the less we rely on those microbes. So when we reduce artificial fertilisers, the regenerative side of soil is that these microbes start doing their job again. So there is a tipping point where the return on investment in terms of yield by putting artificial fertiliser on is reduced. You don't get as big a bang for your buck, so to speak. So if that is correct, do we need the science to absolutely help farmers make that decision to reduce nitrogen and artificial fertilisers? Because there will be, after a period, some of that reduction in productivity will increase because the microbes in the soil will actually start to do their job again. And again, we're back to that transition. But as part of the solution, actually, knowledge transfer from the scientists, from you guys, down to the grassroots farmers to persuade them that doing things differently won't, in the long term, affect their bottom line and their economic sustainability. I'm looking to see who's nodding again. Pete, would you like to come in on that? Or beg your pardon, it was Rob. Rob was going to respond.
Yeah, I'm very happy to respond to that. I can give you a nice example of that, which brings many of these things together. So we've got an Esme Fairbairn funded project on looking at crop mixtures, which is basically just growing two species together rather than growing them in monoculture. And there's lots going on as part of that. Some of that is about the biology. And so the relationship between biodiversity in the system and the way that it functions on average tends to be positive. And on average, the gain from adding biodiversity is most when you're in species poor systems. So if you're in a crop system, if you go from one to two to three crops growing together, then the soil functions and the other functions that we were talking about, they do on average increase. One of the things that we find with crop mixtures, for example, is that enables us to reduce the inputs, so the nitrogen inputs that go into the system, and maintain and in fact even in some cases increase yield with reduced inputs. So there's a saving there, a financial saving and an environmental saving. and we've got a more sustainable system because, for example, there you've got you can have pea barley mixes which can go for animal feed. So we've reduced our global footprint. So there are these ways that we can transition to a more sustainable farming practice, which have both economic and environmental benefits. And one of the key parts about that work is that we're working with farmers as scientists. So we're having on-farm trials, and the farmers are providing us with data, and they're part of the solution, and they're telling us what the real problems are. Many of them would like to grow crop mixtures, but the solutions are partly about what to grow where, what's the best stuff to put in. But also it's technical, it's simple technical things like having a separator for the mixed crop. You can't sell it if it's, in many cases, if it's combined. You need a separator. Not many people have separators. So it's not just the biology, it's these practical challenges. But it reflects really on a point that was made about the marine research. You have to have the farmers, you have to have the fishermen as part of the research. And we can enable that through the technologies, the online technologies that we've got. And I think that's something that we need to look at moving forward. To roll these things out more widely, we need to take this online, work with farmers, and have these online systems for gathering data so that we can work with farmers to tailor the solutions. So I think, but crop mixture is a really nice example of the potential, but something that's still relatively small scale.
Thank you. And Pete, do you have a comment?
Rob's answer was great. I think the other thing that could be considered, if there is a short-term yield penalty in transforming to a farming system that gives you a slightly reduced yield, we could consider the farming subsidy system, which is, you know, the new system is going to provide more public goods. We could provide a proportion of that funding for providing those public goods, which make up for the drop in the private goods, as in like the reduced yield to the farmer. So it doesn't have to be a big subsidy, because there would probably only be a small yield reduction, but that public funding could be considered for those sorts of farms to enable that transition, which gives more public goods from the farming system.
Thank you, Pete. I'll move to Jim for a final question on sustainable agricultural management.
Yeah, I'm just going to come back on one or two of the points that have been made there. In terms of doing mixed combinable crops, that again has been getting done for years. You can sow grass with barley. There are various things that are happening in agriculture. And I'm going to re-emphasise the point that you are all making, but I think it needs to be absolutely clarified, that the farmers are ahead of the game already. They're doing stuff because they want to do it. They want to have their farms to hand on to the next generation. And I think there needs to be far more cognizance of that publicly and in the scientific community. But I will move on. The role of the livestock in global sustainable food systems, considering both climate change and biodiversity, and what the conversations around eating less meat and dairy mean for livestock farming in Scotland. But I would also like to come back to what we talked about in the sustainable and the marine section earlier on, is how does Scotland's system differ from the global system? Because that's another misnomer that I think we really need to get through. Mark, can we come to you first, please?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's a very sensitive issue, of course, but I think that it is important to recognise the difference between UK and especially Scottish livestock farming and the global systems. And in various studies, that distinction has been made also at high level terms of grass-fed systems versus intensive systems. And even within grass-fed systems, Scottish beef or Scottish agriculture is probably on the more sustainable side of the scale. I don't know whether one of my colleagues has the stats to back that up. The other thing that I think we should realise is that just by, and this is for quite a few points actually, but the environment of Scotland lends itself to historically to a number of agricultural activities. And we should recognise that we should also in the future make the most of our natural conditions. And so growing grass and having livestock is one of the things that we're naturally good at. So I think we should emphasize that point to the general public and to the sector. Well, the sector knows it, but that should be emphasized from a scientific perspective. And within that, there's an element that I've been wondering for a while, but it is to what extent should we take responsibility for the fact that we can grow certain things, and that also includes trees. We can grow them well in Scotland with the environmental conditions that we have, should we not emphasise the fact that we should make the most of that instead of importing or exporting our goods to other parts of the world? So rather than growing or having livestock in other parts of the world or growing trees in other parts of the world, we're good at it here, and we should take the responsibility that at least a significant amount of the land that we use should be used for the things that we are environmentally or suited to do.
I think Pete would like to come in the back of that.
I differ slightly from Mark on that, in that we need a transformational change in our agriculture. We know that livestock per unit of mass or per unit of protein or calorie is 10 to 100 times more damaging in terms of climate change than plant-based products. We know that it uses 10 to 100 times more land. We know that livestock agriculture uses 70% of global fresh water, and we know that it's a major driver of biodiversity loss. So we absolutely should consume less meat and dairy. That would also be better for our, the health of our citizens. But how do we manage that? It will have impacts, of course, on our farming sector. But we have to manage that by moving. It has to be a just transition. So we have demand side changes. We request our citizens, or we try and promote healthy eating among our citizens, so we consume less meat and dairy. But we can consider a less and better. You know, I've heard this mentioned in the livestock industry before. Less and better meat, so that we have less and we consume less meat, less ruminant products, less dairy, but we make it better. So we focus less on those intensive systems, which are more environmentally damaging, and we focus more on the systems that produce our livestock in a more relatively more sustainable way. And the last thing that goes along with that is that it does mean that probably some farmers who are receiving subsidies at the moment to produce livestock which wouldn't be economic without their subsidies, we have to provide them with a means of diversification. We have to retrain them, we have to upskill them so that they can be part of the just transition, so that they don't lose their livelihoods in rural societies. But we can't reach net zero. We can't tackle our biodiversity targets by just fiddling around at the edges of our system. We have to think big, and it is going to mean some fundamental changes in what we produce and what we consume in our country if we're to meet net zero by 2045.
Thank you. And Mark, before I move on to a supplementary from Rachel.
Yeah, I don't agree. I disagree with what Pete says. I absolutely agree that we do need change. I think that a lot of the or some of the polarized debate that we're having certainly out in the general public is not helpful, and that there is a place for livestock, probably more extensive, but livestock within Scotland, and that it doesn't help to to polarize the debate to the extent that we have a huge argument against people who eat meat, or people who buy meat, or people who produce meat.
Thank you, Mark. I'm very conscious of time now. We've got 20 minutes left, so I'll move for a quick supplementary from Rachel.
I completely agree there that we shouldn't be making a polarised discussion here on whether importing avocados, cutting down rainforest to grow soya, in an argument that is against a carbon footprint of a farmer producing homegrown foods in Scotland. But anyway, moving on, there seems to be uncertainty about the contribution of greenhouse gas from agriculture, specifically the calculation of methane emissions. I just wondered if the panel had a view on that. Mark again, please. Oh, and Pete after.
If we go to Mark and then Pete.
I'm happy to hand over to Pete.
Okay.
Pete.
I guess we're referring to the GWP star metric, yeah. Which is a different way of calculating climate footprint of methane, because it's a short-lived greenhouse gas. It has a big effect early in the life of methane, but it has a less effect long-term. The upside of that is that you can say by keeping the livestock industry a constant number of animals, then you're not having any net contribution to climate change because that's going to be gone from the system quickly. But the downside of that from the livestock production system is it makes methane a very attractive target for methane for addressing climate change in the short term. That's why out of COP we had this global methane pledge, which was to reduce methane emissions by 30% relative to 2020, by a number of parties have signed up to that. That's mainly going to be by reducing emissions in the oil and gas sector, but it also applies to reducing methane from the livestock sector. So on the one hand, it could benefit the livestock sector in that you could say we're overestimating the climate impact of methane, but reducing methane would have a large impact. It's thought the global methane pledge could reduce global temperatures by about 0.2 degrees going out to 2030. So that's a real big impact. So it could be that by using this metric, by looking at the short-term impacts of methane, it puts methane in the focus for rapidly reducing emissions in the short term, which would mean either fewer emissions per animal or could mean a reduction in the total population of livestock, the total number that we raise. And I'll go back to my earlier point. I don't disagree with Mark. We're not trying to say, I don't think anybody's trying to say we want to demonize livestock and that we all have to become vegan. It's going to take a balanced approach with reduced consumption of meat and dairy, which we overconsume at the moment in this country. And it will mean a balancing of that also on farm. But this less and better, I think this less and better way of looking at meat and dairy could be the way to go, which could provide sustainable livelihoods for farmers that produce their beef and dairy and sheep less intensively. In the bioclimatic conditions that we have, which is ideal for raising cattle, as opposed to just producing just meet an output level. So less and better, I think, is probably where we could coalesce.
Thank you. We now need to move on to our next theme, which is forestry, and I'll ask Jenny to ask the first question.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. I'm interested to hear your views on the importance of forestry for climate change mitigation and growing the right tree in the right place. As Professor Metzger said, you know, there's a balance to be got, and I think every answer we've always indicated there's a balance. The UK is a mass importer of forestry, of timber, so that's on one side, but on the other side, we want to also protect our existing trees and their associated biodiversity. So I'd just like to get the panel's thoughts on that, getting that balance right. Will I start with Professor Brooker?
Yeah, thanks very much. This is clearly a very topical issue at the moment. I think the theme of the right trees in the right place for the right reason is probably the thing to consider. And some of the challenges that we've got at the moment are that the mechanisms for increasing our forestry don't take into effect the localized conditions. So if you put trees on organo-mineral soils, which are halfway between the sort of lowland mineral soils and the deep peats, actually, if you've got the wrong tree and you've got the wrong soil, you're going to get a net loss of carbon. So it really doesn't make any sense in terms of planting trees there. So just having an area metric, it's not the way to do it. You need localized solutions. I think the other challenge with respect to the benefits for biodiversity is that some things win from planting trees, and it certainly depends on what you plant. If you plant a nice native woodland, you know, that's really good for biodiversity compared to a sort of monoculture stand. But some of our biodiversity habitats are treeless, and we wouldn't really want to plant them up. So species-rich grassland, for example, is a nice example of actually where we need livestock to help manage that grassland as part of our biodiversity conservation. So it's a good argument in favour of keeping some grazing systems going. So it's got to be about having the capacity in the system to do the right tailored management. And that has to be backed up by improved scientific knowledge about what the carbon balances and the other balances will be if you put woodlands on a particular area. We've got some of that evidence, we know some of that data, but to provide good information and good support to land managers, there's more that we need to do around that to help tailor those local solutions.
Okay, thank you. I can't see the rest of the panel. Does anybody else like to come in?
Pete?
Professor Smith.
Yeah, so just to say that whilst we require sort of our woodlands, they have to be in the right place, the right tree and the right soil, as has been said. And for biodiversity, and for carbon storage in the long run, native forests are the best option. But we also have to remember that 80% of our timber is currently imported. And we need, as part of the climate solution, to replace coal and steel in the construction industry, we need more timber. So whilst we're relying on 80% of that timber being imported, that also suggests that we should be increasing our production timber capacity within Scotland as well. So I think focusing on just native species which co-deliver biodiversity would be a mistake, in that we also need production forestry to produce timber to replace concrete and steel in the construction industry. So we're going to need a mixed approach of production forestry and native plantings for biodiversity and for carbon sequestration. And that's probably going to require even more area to be planted up with trees of some sort. But it has to be a mixed portfolio of forestry, I think.
Just on that. So We talk about the right tree in the right place, but also balance with the need for timber. Surely that also applies to food. So we need the right cow or the right sheep in the right place to fulfil our food security needs. So I suppose it's all down to regional land use and that sort of thing. But is there an argument that, we're looking at 25,000 hectares of Sitka potentially being planted, which is a short-term product, so it captures carbon for a limited amount of time while it's growing, and then it gets cut down, and generally in this country at the moment it's used for short-term timber products, so that carbon goes back up into the atmosphere. Is there an argument that we need to do a lot more work to look at native species that potentially capture carbon more rapidly and for longer and stay in the ground for a lot longer before they're harvested? Is that work being done? Rather than seeing 25,000 hectares of Sitka, we maybe need 10,000 hectares of Sitka and 15,000 hectares of traditional native broadleaf. Pete, do you want to come back in on that, or Dr. Black? Dr. Black.
Shall I kick off, Pete, and then hand off to you? So what I'd like to do is reflect on what is it we consider when we're actually expanding our woodlands. We've got a lot of research out there to look at the right tree in the right place and what the opportunities are for different woodland types. But one of the things I'm not sure we do reflect on when it comes to woodland expansion is going back to this definition of sustainable management and sustainable production. Do we reflect on whether it's fair? So is it the short-term economic gains actually reflecting wider societal benefits in the future? Is it balanced? So is it only about productivity, or actually are there wider ecosystem goods and services that need to actually be reflected from that woodland? And will it meet the needs from now and into the future? And I don't know that we're really reflecting on that when it comes to woodland expansion. And I wonder if, again, I hate to say, I keep saying this, if we had a good definition for Scotland of what we want sustainable land use and land management to be, it would help us in making decisions about what we want our woodlands to do for us and deciding, yes, okay, we are comfortable with single stand Sitka in these locations, but actually in other locations for other things, it would be better if we diversify. And then one other comment that I'd like to make on this context is in relation to the fact that we separate forestry and agriculture quite distinctly at the moment. And I think we really need to reflect on the fact there are opportunities there with agroforestry and current agricultural systems, and we need to enable farmers to have the flexibility to actually contribute to woodland expansion in a more flexible manner. Maybe hand over to my colleagues, probably other things they want to say in this.
Can I maybe hand over, we're short of time, can I hand over to Mark, who's indicated he'd like to respond to that?
Yeah, it's come up a couple of times now that the land use and the integrated nature of it. And of course, we have the land use strategy in Scotland that was launched in 2011, and it's fallen flat a bit in recent times. And if we think about integrating climate and biodiversity, then it is important that we do have a land use strategy, and we have that definition of sustainable land use, and that our different sort of fairly siloed policy efforts are more integrated. And we do now have the regional land use pilots, which are very noble in what they're trying to achieve, but they're severely under-resourced. A single pilot covering all of Highlands as a policy officer that gets, there's £30,000 towards that. Now, how can you think about integrated land use and all the issues that we've been talking about if there's so little resource? And so what I really miss from the great energy that started off the land use strategy is to now have actually that definition, have that greater coordination between the different policy silos, and to think of some of these integration issues that we've been discussing here.
Thank you, Matt. That takes us nicely on to one of the issues I think that covers everything, that's data. Can I ask Karen for her questions on data?
Yep, sure. Thank you, convener. And good afternoon to the panel. I'd just like to ask, well, I'll caveat with this with an example. Within my constituency, we have an issue that's having a really severe impact on people and their lives that live there, and that's the issue of urban gulls. And although these are in decline in numbers, they're increasing significantly in certain areas. So this being just one example of the changing environment and one of the, you know, climate impacts on local communities, where is more research needed to understand the drivers and impacts of change in the terrestrial environment? And what do we need in regards to the data to most importantly find solutions to these issues?
Who would like to kick off on that one? Rob?
Yeah, I think we have a big challenge with our data in Scotland. We have a lot of data that's collected, but it's not done in a strategic and integrated way, and that makes it very challenging to do the kind of cross-sectoral analysis that we need. So, for example, linking the biodiversity data to the farming data to look at the benefits that we're getting from some of the greening measures within the CAP funding, that's a real challenge. A lot of the data on biodiversity is collected by the word is amateurs, but they're actually, you know, highly skilled people, but they're doing it for free. There's not a strong funding structure there to help bring that data together. And that was highlighted in the Scottish Biodiversity Information Forum's report on this, which was several years back. Other challenges that we've seen recently, for example, my understanding is that SEWeb is currently just on pause because of the cyber attack at SEPA. So SEPA hosted that. There's no access to SEWeb, as I understand it, at the moment. So I think, as well as the call that Mark made for and Helena made for thinking about integrated sustainable management, to go with that, we need an integrated supporting framework of data gathering so that we can look at the effects of the management that we would like to implement on the various metrics of sustainability that we think are important. And at the moment, we have a lot of very useful data, but it's very fragmented. And I think that's a really key thing. And the other thing that we need is new metrics for some of these aspects of sustainability. So we've talked a lot about soil health, and there is work that is bringing that new understanding on board, but that needs to be integrated with this wider monitoring framework.
Dr. Black.
Hi there. So I'd just like to build on that, and I'll focus on soils for an obvious reason. So 2009, the Scottish Government published the Scottish Soils Framework, and in that there was a proposal to implement a national soil monitoring network. And here we are considerable further down the line, and we really need to see action on the ground. We're at the point now that, as as various people have said, we've got ideas of what soil health metrics could be. We know certain things we need to measure to support the modelling to predict how land use and land use management might change in the future. But actually what we critically lack at the moment is a really good understanding of where we are at now, i.e. the baselines of our Scottish soils. And if we could implement a national soil monitoring network, I think we can really innovate in how we capture existing data, and I'll come back to that, and actually look to fill the gaps through techniques. I'll give a good example. The peatland code is requiring people to gather data from peatland restoration. Those data are feeding back into research and development that are helping to improve how we manage our peatlands and how we predict they're going to change. We need this interaction between land managers on the ground and the research community. And the one example I'd really like to draw on that frustrates me a bit and I'd really like to see something move on is the wealth of data that's collected by farmers or commercial organisations for the agricultural sector. There's a lot of data being generated on a day-to-day basis by people that manage our land. But at the moment, it's not clear how we access that for the national and public good. And also, it's less clear how research communities can access that to help to generate where we go in the future. So if I would like to see two things happen in terms of the data gaps, it's implementing a network, actually getting it on the ground and working to see how we capture data that's being gathered now at the moment. A really good example of that, I think, is there's a large campaign going on in the southwest of Scotland by a new company called AgriCarbon, working with First Milk and Nestle, baselining the dairy farmers in Dumfries and Galloway and Ayrshire and collecting very new and very innovative data on soil carbon stocks. And at the moment, those data are probably actually the most extensive data set on soil carbon stocks, I would dare to say, anywhere in the world, but certainly for the UK and certainly for Scotland. And those are vital in terms of the work that, say, Pete does in modelling how our systems are going to react to climate change and how we can mitigate our systems. So to me, it's actually being able to get the benefit of what's being generated already.
Thank you very much. We're just going to, moving on to our very last question, but can I just want a yes or no answer. And I know they are very difficult, but do the regional land use partnerships, we know they're underfunded, but could they be the body that looks at pulling all this data together and pulling the groups together to make sure we get that you know, national data gathering and soil gathering? Could they be the organisation that could pull all that data together? Just a yes or no, or a nod of the head would be good. One out of three. Okay, thanks. We'll move on to our final question. That's from Rachel, and it's on COP outcomes.
Well, it's a wide question, but you can answer it with a couple of sentences for the sake of time. But what are your takeaways from COP26 with regard to land use and the rural economy? And what are your hopes for COP15, the next stage of COP15, with regards to biodiversity on land?
Can we start with Helena and then move to Rob, Mark and then Pete, please?
Okay, so I'll keep my answer very short because others will have more to say. Two things. I really want to see action on the ground in restoration of our soils and habitats. And the second one is what's going to happen in terms of implementing Article 6 on carbon markets, because that could have a significant impact on management. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
And Rob?
Yeah, thanks. So a major message for me from COP26 is the importance of nature-based solutions, which we've heard a lot about, but this potential for them to deliver 30% of the actions that we need. That's such a clear message. It comes through and directly links to Kunming and CBD COP15. A critical thing about that is that it must involve local stakeholders for equitability. So we've heard the importance of involving farmers and other land managers in Scotland. What I hope for COP15 is that the importance of biodiversity conservation for solving the climate change crisis is actually going to drive more in the way of tangible action for biodiversity conservation, because what we've seen is commitments and continued decline in global biodiversity and some fairly weak targets, which is to stop the or lower the rate of decline. We need to go on that upward curve with biodiversity. So those are my hopes from Kunming, that COP26 really drives some action and stronger commitment on the ground.
Thank you. And Mark?
So for me, the greatest message from COP is the societal expectations for action. So that's outside the formal COP, but the media exposure, what we've seen, how also in Scotland, how society wants change and wants action. I think that's the main message. And I think for Kunming, I think it is the stronger commitments, just like Rob was saying, that we need those and then to implement that for those.
Thank you very much. And finally, Pete.
Yeah, so I think the three big outcomes from COP that will affect the rural communities and rural land use in Scotland are the pledge to halt deforestation and begin restoring forests by 2030. So that ties in with our woodland expansion targets. The global methane pledge, which I mentioned earlier, to limit CO2 to 30% of 2020 levels. By 30% compared to 2020 levels. That will have implications potentially in our trying to tackle greenhouse gas emissions from the agriculture sector, particularly from the livestock sector and manure management, which are the biggest sources of methane emissions. And finally, echoing what Rob said, the emphasis on nature-based solutions that went throughout COP26, I think the increased target of protection of 30% of the land by 2030 means that we need to expand the amount of land that we're putting aside for biodiversity. And that can only happen if we have some systematic changes in the way we support agriculture. So again, it's just coming back to this emphasis on tickling around at the edges of our current system is not going to deliver what we need in terms of biodiversity or climate change. We need a fundamental transformation in the way we produce our food and the way we protect nature.
Can I follow that up with a question about the baseline?
Very quick question, Rachel.
Professor Smith, on the 2020 baseline, should agriculture be taken out of that and recalculated in a different way, considering the conversation that we had earlier?
No, I don't think it should. And if you did calculate it according to a different metric, such as GWP star, it makes the impact of reducing methane emissions now even more important in the coming decade. So rather than decreasing the reliance on reducing methane, it shoves it further up the agenda. So I don't think it would be beneficial.
Okay, thank you very much. And can I thank you all for your really fascinating and useful evidence that you provided this morning. Thank you very much. And that concludes our committee meeting for today. Thank you.